tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's Clarence
time. Let's get ready to rumble. Feel the fire sense of the rare. It's my son only know how.
What is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another edition of Just Another Friday Night, the at-home edition, I guess. I mean, we're normally out of home, but it's normally myself, CM Chuck, and AA Adamantium Adam. But like, I have the computer, he doesn't, so it's like that's why we're here. And he could do a show from his phone. There could be a number of different ways we could do it, but we're choosing not to do it that way, and we're kind of doing it like we did last week again at home here. So instead of AA Adamantium, I have the absolute next best thing, which is Untamable Amy in the house. Sis, how are you doing?
What's up, Friday Nighters? I'm doing good. I just showered and we are starting a little bit late tonight. It's fine.
Well, then the past couple, because we've been doing like 7:30, kind of, we try to make that a regular time. I like to give AA back to his wife, and I also like to get home to hear.
I have no wife, so yeah, I'm good.
Yeah. I mean, you know, not that we don't like, we would just do the show and sit around and hang out, but we have obviously other obligations and stuff. So,
yeah.
You know, I got Fortnite to play, so I like to get home and play some Fortnite too. But yeah, the show is fun. The show is a commitment, but it's fun to be here and do the show. So
absolutely. I'm always... it's always a pleasure to be on the show, especially as a co-host, which is really awesome.
Yeah, you are now for sure the longest running co-host we've had.
It helps that we live in the same household.
Yeah, I've been a guest.
I can't do it. I'll be more than happy to sit in.
Yeah,
those are some big shoes to fill
for sure.
But I do what I can.
For sure, I've been a guest on the Now Watch This podcast like three times, one time unaired or whatever. So, but that's just as a guest host. I've never actually co-hosted the show with him. So, see, you've actually co-hosted this show a couple times with me. So,
yeah, and I'm still learning. So,
and I feel kind of bad because last week I had like all these backup plans and I had you on, and it was like,
I didn't really talk with you that much. I think it was awesome. It was awesome to have people that wanted to be involved in y'all's show.
Yeah.
And be on the show. So that was really cool getting to see everybody's input on different things, and I like that it was of like a variety show. I like that.
Too.
I know you and AA usually don't do that.
No,
but it's
definitely
nice to have that change of pace.
You know, it can be really hard. And guys, that episode I think was a lot of fun, despite the circumstances. But definitely go listen to it, even if you're just listening to the audio on YouTube or watch it on YouTube, because I haven't heard the audio version yet, but I know some of our guests, like, I didn't interrupt them. You know, we break every 30 minutes because Anchor makes you take a break, and I didn't do that. So they probably got their audio cut off on the audio version. So if you hear it on Spotify or iTunes, Jerry D or Alfred, I'm really sorry, guys. Even Sean and Joe, sorry, guys. But you can hear the full thing on YouTube. And while you're there, hit subscribe, because we need some subscribers. We're almost at 60. We're very close to 60 on our YouTube. And forgive me if I sound a little froggy, guys. I am not sick. I had two COVID tests this week. They were both negative. One was the two-day one, like where it takes 2 days to get, and one was a rapid. It cost me $65. You know, because that's what my insurance says, whatever. It all depends on your insurance. So don't be afraid to go get a rapid. It goes solely insurance based. But yeah. And we also got great news from Alfred over at Collector's Cove and the Comic Book Characters podcast. He is also negative. So Alfred, congrats on that. And glad that you're going to be working Ekman's tomorrow. Jason in the house says, "What's up, bro? What's up, Jason? Sorry about the super late start, man. I know I told you earlier eight, but it's not." And before you ask me what's up, Jason, I'm going to give you the heads up on what's up for this weekend. There is going to be the Dale Ekman's Comic Cards and Collectibles show out at the Shriners Auditorium. That's where they had it this last time. It was really successful. It was kind of when things had died down and people went, and it was a great time. We took my nephew, your son.
That was his first time, I think.
At Ekman's? No, I think he might have been once before.
But it was probably a long time ago. Yeah.
Well, you know, the truth is that the pandemic, you know, seemed like such a long time. So it was like a long time since anything had happened or whatever. So it felt like anything that you hadn't done like that, but it was really crowded. It was a really packed show. Now things are on the rise. So I don't know how it's going to be. I haven't read anything on their website about precautions or mask requirements or whatever, but I will highly suggest anybody that go be safe. Yeah. Alfred told me himself that he's going to have a sanitizing station at his booth. So that's really good. Smart and really
good. Because I feel like, I know, like when we see the sanitizer, we use it, or if there's wipes or whatever.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Even if it smells like straight up bottom shelf booze, we still use it. So, yeah, guys, we're going to maybe try to keep it tight because Untamable Amy doesn't like to do a show as long as me and Double A do, or even last week's show, which really drug out, which again, it was so many topics and I think everything deserved time, and I wanted to let everyone have the opportunity to talk that bothered to come and help me out and be on the show. But you know, it was made for all.
Also, I'm not as well versed as AA in a lot of things.
Oh, right. So nor I am I. I yeah.
When we do it, when I you have me on, it has to be something that I am
that we know
with,
that we so. Know. And we went over a couple of things, and this one I was kind of like, I knew she wanted to be on the last one and on this one, but I was going to force her to watch something that I know that I wouldn't get to otherwise do with AA. So,
right.
But I think it was a good suggestion, right?
It was a really good suggestion, and unfortunately, I'm still in the process of watching it, but I did make it through the first season.
Okay.
And I wouldn't say I'm midway through the second season.
I think that you are.
I really did try, bro, because I loved
me.
It. I'm loving it.
Yeah,
and
we'll
I want to finish
if you
it.
Finish.
Yeah. I want to finish it. I'm gonna finish it.
And the only reason why I wanted Untamable Amy to watch is because I'm caught up, and season 3 just premiered or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, you know what? I'm gonna just leave the comments up, guys, during the talk, and because I know it's late, so people probably just think maybe there's not gonna be a show, so they might not jump in or whatever.
Right.
But I'll leave it up for a minute, and then we'll. Do the just read the comments as we go along after talking about the topic tonight. But I do have to take the break every 30 minutes, so I should be more on top of that now that we don't have guests in or whatever. How about some drinks, sis? What do you think?
Yeah, I don't know what we
monkey
got
you want to come and say hello to the Friday Nighters or not tonight? We have the monkey here in the background, he's hanging out in the green room,
he's in the shadows like Batman.
He's in the shadows like Batman. Okay, he doesn't know who wants to come on. And we haven't done any content on our Monkey and the Unky channel because we haven't had anything to unbox yet. You want to say an update about the Monkey and the Unky?
Yeah, well, sorry guys for not having any new videos, but
what?
So hopefully soon we'll be having more videos. So.
All right.
Maybe we'll record tomorrow or the day after. We're not sure. Joe is in the house. Joe says, Shira. Cheer up.
Thank you, Mitch. Cheers.
Cheers. Okay, yeah. All right. Well,
okay,
I'll take one of what you're having.
Okay, so you can go ahead.
We want to bring back a tradition here that we used to do with AA, but AA prefers to just drink his Dos Equis, so we don't make him do the different beers. Sometimes they would be kind of rough to get through, but that doesn't mean that we're not going to have a beer for AA anyway. So AA, just like last time, this bud is for you, buddy. So this one's for AA, who's not here with us today, but he is here with us in spirit.
In spirit.
Oh, well, if I can do it.
Do it. Do it.
Joe says he's one shot in. Can you get that?
One shot in, Joe? Oh, man. I wish that I could have.
I know. Me too. What are you shooting, Joe? What are you having one shot of? And Jace, what are you drinking if you're still here with this? All right. AA. That's the AA. And so we're drinking this. Look, we're going to try this. Untamable Amy and me, we're trying Road Trip Snacks. Where's the good angle right there? Road Trip Snacks. And what does it say, sis?
So this actually is from the Panther Island Brewing. It's brewed in Fort Worth, Texas. And I actually first spotted it at the Central Market HEB. And I really liked the name. I thought it was awesome. Road Trip Snacks. I mean, who doesn't like road trips, let alone the snacks to go with it? But it also says that it's ale brewed with beaver nuggets. From Buc-ee's.
What
the heck? If you've never been to Buc-ee's, you need to go and check it out because I think it's just a must-stop shop for your road trip. And you got to get the beaver nuggets.
There you go.
You need help there?
No, I got it. I trim my nails. And Jason's having a big red. And Joe says Mexican candy shots. Joe, do you make those yourself?
Oh, do you make those yourself? Joe, I want some of those. I'm down.
There's the Irish crickets, as Joe calls it.
Irish
now watch this podcast.
Crickets.
Rich is in the house. Rich, what's up, my man? I hope all is well. Yes, man. Again, you might have missed it. I'm negative. My sister's negative. My mom is now negative.
We're raising the roof.
We might not be seeing anybody for a while because we're like good results and negativity in the good way of not no positive results. So we're happy about that. So here is we're trying the road trip snacks brewed with beaver nuggets from Fort Worth. Says cheers to you.
Cheers,
and
cheers
double
to
A,
you guys.
This one's for you. It's going to be up here all night, double A, because you're here with us in spirit.
It smells hoppy. It
smells hoppy?
Mm.
It looked dark because it kind of splashed out of my can. Oh.
It's very rich.
That's I don't taste the beaver nuggets.
I don't taste any sweetness. I actually like it. It kind of like reminds me of when I first drank Guinness for the first time in a long time.
Yeah, I get that vibe.
I know you like
it.
Guinness. I like Guinness too, but I'm not. I know you, CM Chuck, have actually gone out and bought it and had some at home, but
yeah. And if you see the little guy there, he's kind of munching on beaver nuggets there. He kind of looks like what's the guy? Hank Williams the second. Are you ready for some football?
Part two. Oh no.
So Joe says watermelon mix, tahini, and silver tequila for Mexican candy shots. All right, very tough, Joe.
I'm gonna have to maybe get that.
I gotta have a one night, Friday night, or one on Jay Dallas to tell a story about when we were at El Luchador and some bikers bought us shots. I'll tell that. Let that story be told then later. But yeah, Rich, what are you drinking, brother? And yes, thanks to God, as he says, for sure, man. We were so happy that everyone came out negative. And I think we might have. We said we weren't gonna have any guests, but I guess we have Grogu in the house. Grogu is here. Oh man, it's getting crazy with Grogu in the house. So very, very cool. Also, major news just getting broken to me right now. Our wrestling fans, guys, if you're watching the second show that comes out for AEW, that's All Elite Wrestling, that's kind of like the number two right now to WWE, there has been rumors. Tonight they are in Chicago, the hometown of the iconic, one of my favorites, a legendary, CM Punk has debuted. He is back. He is in AEW.
See, now that's the wrestling that I was watching, like when he was...
Yeah, okay, Grogu, we gotta take off, buddy, because you're gonna spill these beers on the computer and we're gonna have a bad night if that happens. So you're welcome to come and sit in with us, you know what I mean, if you want.
When CM Punk was wrestling, that was my boy. And
but
I
you know what, before CM Punk, you used to always say, oh, my time is The Rock and Undertaker and Stone Cold.
Well, yeah, well, then after they were gone, then they started coming out with these new guys and stuff, and CM Punk's was one of my boys, but... Honestly, Taker has always been my man since day one.
Yeah, for sure.
When
for
he,
sure.
You know, I didn't care for his biker phase, but I still loved him then. That's been my man for a minute.
Yeah, no, I definitely get it. I'm a big Stone Cold guy, but I know that Joe from Now Watch This is a big... Sorry if the camera keeps shaking, guys. You got to watch the table, buddy, because you keep knocking the cameras moving like this. looks like we're in an earthquake. I'm a huge CM Punk fan too. I probably got like freaking must have 30 or 40 just CM Punk t-shirts. I probably have every shirt he came out with while he was a WWE.
Yeah, I know you have.
And you know what? If I wasn't doing the show tonight and I had cable still, I probably would be looking at AEW to see that
cable.
Because, yeah, which we're glad we cut the cord. But I'm going to look at all the clips afterwards. I want to see it. I want to know if he fights or does he just come out and talk. You know what I mean? But it's kind of cool. It's kind of big, exciting wrestling news. I mean, there's a big name back. Supposedly, they're going to get Daniel Bryan, too, real name Bryan Danielson. You know, so that's two huge Ring of Honor alumni that are elite guys from Ring of Honor. And for them to be in AEW, I mean, AEW's been getting
flack. But Daniel Bryan's been wrestling.
Yeah, he had been. He took a little break. He took a couple of breaks. And he had got hurt, and then they thought his career was over. But then, like, you know, suppose he got better, and he came back. He had a good run back at WWE, and then he didn't renew his contract. So they're saying that, you know, AEW may be the place to go now, whatever. And AEW does have a lot of talent. People's feelings are very mixed and strong about both places. Joe says, sad, sad, sad. You can't deny what Punk brings to the wrestling world, though, and I'd love to see him mix it up with Kenny Omega. So, for as a wrestling fan, it's exciting. Bill Hill in the house. Bill says, and that is a real name, folks. Theo Bill, Uncle Bill, glad to see you tonight, sir. We came home smelling like barbecue, so that also added a little bit to our lateness. But he says, Guinness is good and good for the soul. Yeah. So, you know, Bill, would you try Road Trip Snacks brewed with beaver nuggets? I want to know if this is up your alley.
Also, Kylo's on there.
Yeah, there's a little dog. It looks like our dog, Kylo. Let's see what else did I miss. Rich says he's having water tonight. Rich, I was drinking some water too, man. I was feeling dehydrated. So yeah. For sure. Joe says, what about those straight whiskey shots? Yes, I remember that. That probably wasn't my brightest moment, but that's normally what I do. Joe says, no one's watching that shit regarding AEW. Rich says, but for them to be there on their own stage, they need to get wrestlers to bring up like Stone Cold and Taker. Yeah, agree. And they have guys like that. They have guys like the Young Bucks and Kenny Omega, which definitely have talent or whatever. And they've been on the circuit for so long. You know what I mean? They were all part of the Bullet Club when it was in Japan, and that was like blowing up big. You know, I think there's a lot of room there to grow. And I think that certain wrestlers want to go there for some of the independence they don't have at WWE. But me, I'm all for good wrestling. It doesn't matter where it comes from. It could be at the local, you know,
gymnasium
or whatever. You know what I mean? And if anybody wants to see my tryout at RCW wrestling,
yeah, I was just going to say, you know, it takes a lot, I think, to even get up.
Joe there. Had a good laugh at it. Yeah, for sure. Rich says, that's the only reason I don't watch it. No, I totally get you, man. I mean, like, you know, to me with wrestling, it's like, it's real easy to get out of it, but it's also real easy to get back into it. Cause if you start watching it and you see one guy you like you're a Roman Reigns fan, you know what I mean? Like, he's like at the top right now. He's a bad guy right now, but he's at the top right now. You know what I mean? It's like, he might be the only guy, you know, watching, but once you see, you know, you're one guy, and I think Cena's kind of coming back. Obviously he's super hot off of Suicide Squad.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, it just takes you that one guy to be like, okay, I'm going to watch these two guys.
Right.
But while you're waiting, you're watching another match, whatever. I used to watch wrestling while I ironed clothes for work. So it would make it easy to just, I'm ironing clothes, I'm looking, I'm kind of watching the matches in a minute.
I probably would have got more into wrestling. I was into wrestling, and I loved a lot of the male wrestlers, but I always wanted them to have more, like, badass, like, chick wrestlers or whatever, which I'm sure there are, but I guess I like a certain type of woman wrestler. Like, I really loved Chyna.
Mm-hmm.
I loved her style because she would fight dudes.
Yeah.
You know, and I did, like, I was kind of feeling Glamazon, but again, like, they're both Beth fucking Phoenix. Jacked, you know? And they're not.
Well, you've seen Nia Jax, right?
Nia too, I mean, badass, she's pretty buff or whatever, but she's not jacked like Chyna was.
No, she's not, but I mean, I think she can still move for a woman her size.
Yeah, well, I never really, I guess I never really grew to love any of the women ones. Yeah. So I wouldn't watch, so I don't know how they wrestle.
You didn't like the little foofy, frilly, pretty girls.
Yeah.
You know who you would like? You would love Double A's girl that he likes a lot, Jordan Grace.
Okay,
she and I loved... I think Impact, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but she is buff, sis, but she's beautiful too, but she's a, you could tell, you know what I mean? Like, you
well, know, I like, I think, is it Asuka?
Yeah, oh yeah. Asuka is badass.
Yeah. I like her too. And she's petite, she's small, but I guess I just like her style, whatever. And then of course, like when Bayley first came out, like Bayley was my girl.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. See, Bayley's a badass.
Yeah. Bayley's a badass. I really like the aspect of her when she was, she first came out, you know, the side ponytail, the 80s look. And I'm not going to lie, when she changed it up, I was like, I know you grow from things and you change and everything, but that was my girl when she first came out.
I just want to show Amy Jordan Grace real quick. So
I actually was Bailey for one Halloween because I really loved her a lot. Okay.
Kind of scroll.
Yeah.
She calls herself Thick Mama Pump. And I've yet to really see any of her matches, but I mean, I'm really impressed, obviously, her physique and, like, you know, you know, I've seen a little, like, clips. I would not say a match with her, but yeah, she's really badass.
Yeah, she's pretty, you know, buff.
So that is big breaking news. So thanks to Sean, who was on the show last week as a guest talking wrestling with Joe. Yeah, I told him, send me a picture from your TV screen when it happens. Because to me, it ain't real on the interwebs until I see it with my own eyes. So he sent me a screenshot of his phone.
Don't believe everything you see on the internet, bro.
For real. And so, I mean, it's there. Punk is there. I cannot wait to watch a replay and watch a clip. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, I'm sure that's going to be awesome.
And it would give me reason to turn on AEW. And I told AA about this. I said, was he going to be watching at home? And he said, no, probably not. And he said, he goes, I don't know what it would take for him to get back into, I guess, like current time wrestling. You know?
Yeah, I know AA is more of like a back
old
then.
School, old school wrestling. Old school, definitely. You know what I mean? But I think there are things, you know, we were watching when excuse me, the guys at the Bullet Club were wrestling at Japan, which was not that long ago. I mean, like maybe 2 years ago, whatever. Yeah. Like we were like getting together to go watch it because we knew how good it was going to be. And it was really great matches. Yeah. So I'm mainly thinking of like Wrestle Kingdom, which is like the Japanese WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. And Kenny Omega, that's the road trip snacks getting to you right there. But anywho, that aside, is there anything else pop culture wise that you saw that's come out? Where I am watching What If. You're not caught up.
I know. I can't do two shows. Okay. But you feel free to talk about it, bro.
No, I'm not, because I'm saving that. Guys, more than likely, and this is a reveal, that will be our topic next week. I should be back reunited with AA, and I think we're going to do What If. So,
well, hopefully maybe I can watch it between now and then I can be.
It's just two episodes right now, guys, and if you're not watching it, you're truly missing out. They get a lot of the freaking voice cast from the movies.
Yeah, I thought that was cool.
Yeah, really cool. The first episode, Captain Carter. You know what I mean? Kind of like, what if it wasn't Steve that got the serum? And then the excellent, and
Don't be getting emotional. Moving
and touching episode, you know, the What If T'Challa was Star-Lord episode with, you know, Chadwick Boseman's actual voice on there. So,
yeah.
But yeah, guys, go check out What If on Disney Plus if you haven't already, because it's super badass. Jason says, I like Trish Stratus. She was a badass. Yeah, AA got to meet her at a convention, Jason. So she was going, I shook her hand, but I didn't get a picture with her. I think AA did. But yeah, Trish was really, really awesome in her time.
Yeah, I know she was a badass, though, because I would hear her name a lot. But during that time, I wasn't really watching.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Okay. Guys, I can't think of anything else on top of my head that I wanted to talk about pop culture wise. So I'm just going to move us right into the topic.
All right.
And we'll talk about it. And if anybody has anything they want to talk about when I do the 30-minute break, let me know. And we'll talk about that pop culture topic. When I don't think anybody sadly didn't die or anything like that or whatever.
Only real life folks we know, unfortunately.
Yeah. So, yeah. There was. Have you been following the Jeopardy kind of controversy thing, whatever, that people want LeVar Burton to host or whatever?
I mean, I had heard that because.
I said I'm going to get into the show right then. I sidetracked, but go ahead. No, go ahead. What did you hear?
The host or whatever.
Alex Trebek. He passed away.
He passed away.
Right.
But he had already retired, or
no? He was still hosting. I think he hosted up. Well, I think they might have had some guest hosts towards the end or whatever.
Okay.
But it wasn't decided or whatever. Right. So, you know, like everybody was pulling on. Jason says regarding Trish, she was his crush. yeah, I think a lot of guys, Jason, for sure. But regarding LeVar, regarding Alex Trebek, he passed. And then they were going to get – sorry, guys, you can hear our dog because we have him outside. So he's not like jingling around. Well, he's not going to go to bed yet. So not till 9:30, I don't think. So we'll give him about 10 minutes.
Yes, the dogs have bedtime.
Yes, the dogs have bedtime. One does. The other one just kind of wanders. But you know what? Yeah, you can get him.
Okay.
So can you hear me while I'm talking?
Yeah, go ahead.
So anyways, guys, if you don't know, so Alex Trebek passed. I think they were maybe doing guests. He had cancer. Or maybe they were doing guest hosts towards the end. But anyway, when he got done, everybody was saying, well, we really would like LeVar Burton. You know, people our age now remember LeVar Burton from Reading Rainbow. And obviously he was.
Do you want me to let him?
Yeah, you can put him in the cage. Okay. Sorry, guys. This is the joys of being at home, right? Work from home. So yeah, double A's, we have a designated room for podcasting. But so people were just like, the fans kind of came out and said, you know, we want LeVar Burton. Everybody loved it. They had a bunch of different guest hosts. Even I think Aaron Rodgers from the Green Bay Packers, I think, guest hosted. And apparently people said he did really well. I'm not a fan. But, you know, people were still like clamoring for LeVar Burton. So finally he got his turn to guest host and he did really great. And then some other guy hosted. And this guy is apparently like an executive producer or something like that of Jeopardy. So he executive produces or whatever, and then he pretty much kind of gets offered the job. Joe says, sorry, I had to go cry for a bit. But yeah, so was it about Alex Trebek, Joe, or was it about the CM Punk thing? You could still like CM Punk, Joe. Hopefully it's still going to be awesome. But anyway, what I was saying is right. So then this other guy guest hosted, and he's like an executive producer, and he covered it, and he'll just keep you happy.
No, I think if he sees us.
Oh, okay. So anyway, so then they're like, oh, the Jeopardy producers are leaning on this guy being the host. Everyone was like, that executive producer guy? Like, he's like nobody. Like, he's behind the scenes, but he's been a part of the show for whatever. Uh-huh. And they said he was pivotal in, like, helping choose the next host of Beast. Cheers, Steve. Thanks for joining us, bud. Sorry we're late. But anyway, so, and I'll wrap this up and then we'll get into the topic in those last couple minutes here. So then it starts coming out, well, he's going to get the job. Well, then the fans all got pissed off because they were like, well, it sounds to us like you already had him all the time in mind. So this guest host shit and all of our campaign from LeVar Burton was for nothing. And so it was like very like whatever. Well, then, you know, as things go in today's society, sometimes cancel culture comes in handy. Because what did they do? They dug up dirt on him. They found out that they were like, oh, this guy makes like anti-Jewish comments in meetings. He's very shitty behind the scenes. Treats his staff like shit. So within like a week, guys, this guy is like, I'm declining the job and I'm going to step down. Now, he has been fired from Jeopardy. He's still going to be behind the scenes in his whatever role he was, but he's not going to take the hosting job. He probably saw right away that they were like, these fucking fans were going to come after him or whatever. Yeah. Now, there hasn't been no word on LeVar Burton yet. But the next guest host, I believe, is supposed to be Mayim Bialik. Blossom.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, also from Big Bang Theory or whatever.
So. I could see her doing that job, maybe.
Yeah.
But yeah. I would be all for LeVar.
I'm all for LeVar. And the fans are 100% behind him. And you know what? He has also said that it was a dream job of his. So I'm like, why wouldn't you give it to the guy that everyone says the same thing? They're like, this guy taught us about reading and books and education growing up. Why wouldn't you give it to him? You know, so I don't know. I'm not, you know.
So it's funny that we're talking about him real quick is that we all know about my son, the monkey.
Uh-huh, the monkey.
You know, I always want him to watch shows that we watched when we were younger.
Yeah.
And movies that we watch. I always tell him, I give him a hard time. Like, you never want to watch any of the Disney movies, like the old ones. And actually not that long ago, a couple months ago, during the summertime, he actually watched like 101 Dalmatians with me. And we started Aladdin, but he didn't get all the way through because it was like, okay, just one movie per night, Mom. I can't do two new ones. And,
yeah,
you know.
That's a lot.
So, well, for him it is, yeah. But yeah. Just to get him to sit through an original Disney movie was really awesome. Well, I wanted to show him some other shows that I had watched when we were younger, and one of them was Reading Rainbow. So he watched one episode with me.
Where is like it at?
The first episode. It's on, I don't even know what it's on. It's okay. On one of the apps we have, okay. Like in Hulu, or we have so many show apps. I don't even know which one it was.
I hate it.
But he actually said he did like the one that we watched. Really? And he wanted me to show him some other shows from when we were younger. So I was really happy that I got to share that with him because I haven't seen Reading Rainbow in forever. It's been done aired like forever ago. So
yeah, I was just hearing Jerry Davila from Totally Rad Christmas on his podcast talking with, I didn't get all the way through the episode, but his most recent episode is comparing Christmas Simpson episode to Bob's Burgers. And the very first episode of The Simpsons, I believe when it became a show, was a Christmas episode. It's where they get Santa's Little Helper. That episode like by heart.
We actually showed Kal-El that we watched the very first episode of The Simpsons because he likes The Simpsons.
Yeah, he loves The Simpsons. But the guy he was talking to was younger. Like, he was younger than you. So he's like a young guy. Like, I think in his friends, like I think The Simpsons debuted before this guy was born. And so as they were discussing it, they kind of got into a conversation. And I thought it was interesting that Jerry chose a guy like that to do that show with. They were talking about how some things didn't age well. And I was like, yeah, I get it. Sometimes some things don't age well or whatever. Yeah. But it was interesting contrast because the younger guy was saying, he goes, man, it's funny what you could do back then to get a laugh. Like, that was like, whatever it was like a solid joke. And he's like, nowadays you couldn't do stuff like that. Yeah. Like, you couldn't say stuff like that. But it's so funny because there's so many things like that. Like, if you look at like All in the Family, you know, Carol O'Connor, it was like, you know, he made a lot of really racist jokes that definitely wouldn't fly now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But back then it was like, there was other things that you couldn't do or say on TV that you can do now. Like, you know, you can say, you know, bitch and ass on TV, like a lot.
Right.
It's like, you couldn't say that back then or whatever, but here you could be making like racial jokes.
It's funny what they thought was allowed to be allowed then.
Right.
And now, yeah, times are different. Times have changed. So, you know, movies that were made, you know, in the 70s and 80s, you couldn't make those today. I mean,
yeah, no, you really couldn't. There's just not, you know what I mean? You know, we talked about, you know,
nobody can't have nothing.
Yeah, one of my favorite comedians, and you know, I don't know about AA, I don't know about you, but like Andrew Dice Clay, you know what I mean? Like, I very controversial, very, very raunchy. And it's supposed to be coming to play the AT&T Center soon or whatever, but I'm just wondering, what does this guy's act like now?
I mean, because Rodney Dangerfield, too.
I mean,
maybe not as much as.
Yeah, I don't think as much. Rodney poked a lot of fun at himself, whatever, but Clay was very, like, racial, very, like, sexist, very, like, homophobic. It was like really, really, like, you know, at the time, edgy comedy. I mean, the guy was banned from MTV, you know, so it's interesting in its own right. But
it's like they say, it's just jokes.
it's just jokes, right? That's what the comedians always say. They say, you know, you got to understand that this is being told in the context of a comedy show. You know, you take any one of their comments out of the show and it sounds really bad or whatever. And I heard that Louis C.K. was making a comeback too, a comeback tour. And
I love Louis C.K.
They were saying, though, that they were like, his comedy's changed. He's not as, you know, funny anymore, that there's like a bitterness about him now and the comedy and the jokes. They said he even comes out with like this bright banner behind him that just says like sorry on it. And they're like, he never makes reference to what he did or the things that happened or whatever. And that's like such a hollow apology. Of course, this is one article that I read. It was written by a female or whatever in her perspective. And I'm sure that considering the things that, you know, he was kind of accused of or whatever, it must seem like a really half-hearted, you know what I mean? But either way, he's trying or whatever. Yeah. And if he can get back to being the funny guy he was, I mean, maybe people will accept it.
But. I mean, to even get up there after all that, to try to make a comeback is saying something, but.
Yeah. Guys, we're right at the first 30-minute break, so I'm going to take that 30-minute break right now. I'm going to read through the comments, guys. We're going to kind of be back to the normal format. Then we're going to see how tight of a show me and Amy can keep it on a really cool topic, guys. We'll tell you more about right now. If all the background in our t-shirts don't reveal it, they don't. It's a secret. All right, guys. Sorry that I didn't lead you into the break, but if you just heard me doing 30 seconds of a commercial, you're listening to us on audio. Hopefully, it's a lot tighter than last week's, where, unfortunately, I let some of my guests talk into the break. And we missed some of their stuff. But if you ever want to hear the full episode, unabridged, excuse me, all of the wonderful things they had to say from Alfred to Jerry to Joe to Sean, go check us out on YouTube.com. Search Just Another Friday Night. We're almost at 100 subscribers. When we get to 100, we can change the name to YouTube.com/Just Another Friday Night.
Oh, that's
We're not
awesome.
Quite there yet.
Spread the word, guys. Let them know.
Yeah. Yeah. We got a beer cracked in the back for
Double A.
That's a picture of me and Jess back there. And I got my man back here, Nightwing, and he's also right over here. Which brings us to our subject, guys. Tonight's show is not about Batman, despite what you see on our t-shirts. And Joe says Landshark. Landshark's some good shit, bro. Yeah. I like that. You can buy me some. But we're talking about a show, as the title indicates, that I barely picked up. Okay, so this show came out a while back on when DC decided to do their own streaming service. So Marvel was already on Disney, but DC was like, we're going to do our own. We're going to have our own streaming network with original shows.
Because so it's DC, like you can get the app DC?
Yeah, at the time it was. Yeah, because everybody was like up on that or whatever. And everybody was just doing their own thing. There's like an AMC app. There's a freaking, you know, whatever. So
yeah, everyone like every TV station has their own.
And the thing was like Netflix kind of maybe was the ones that started it, where it's like, we're going to have original content, like Stranger Things. Like, this is our own show. You can only watch this here. It's exclusive. So it's like, okay. But of course, fans and people get tired of that. And they're like, fuck that. I mean, like, I just want to watch it, whatever. But I remember this idea or this show trailer, I think, premiered at that DC fandom, which is probably like, you know, more than a year ago, because that was around the time that me and AA started the podcast. Mm-hmm. And I remember watching the trailer and I thought it was cool. The show was called Titans. Mm-hmm. And what made it badass was that in that preview, you see that scene that's like in the first 5 minutes of episode one, where it's, you know, Dick Grayson as Robin saying, fuck Batman. So you're like,
not my favorite line, by the way.
You're like, whoa, this is like a grown up. This is not Teen Titans. This is not Teen Titans Go. This is, and I'm only going to pull up my IMDb, guys, because I don't have all the actors' names remembered yet, which I
do like Teen Titans Go, though. Me and Kella would watch that, and I liked it. It was good.
But this is not that. This is just the show Titans. And again, the DC app is now gone. It is now, HBO owns all of it. So it's now on HBO Max. That's where I watched it. Again, after season one and two were already done. And I started hearing and seeing talks about season three. And I was like, man, I really want to watch this show and get caught up for season three. So Dick Grayson is played by an actor named Brenton Thwaites. I think I'm saying that right.
I'm just curious.
My phone's dying, so it's going to die. But that's the cast. I put some of them in the their names in the thing there. But I told, this is something that probably AA wouldn't watch with me. I'm sure he has a watch list like I do of shit he's got to watch or whatever. And if I'm like, hey, watch a whole fucking show, you know what I mean? It's like, that's a lot to put on somebody or whatever. And mind you, we didn't know what's going to happen and maybe it would have worked out. But you know what I mean? Regardless, I know that I can ask, you know, Untamable Amy to watch something. And most times she's going to go forward or whatever. Although she still hasn't watched The Boys. She hasn't watched Invincible. So. But I mentioned
working my way through. I have a child.
I mentioned in the write-up that this is I would say kind of in that vein, not as intense. Those two are very intense, but this is definitely in that vein. So it's an adult take on it. Now, let me ask you something. There's Teen Titans and there's Teen Titans Go.
So
what's the difference?
The Teen Titans Go, I think, was it was more, they wanted it to be more for like, because I think it was on Cartoon Network. Mm-hmm. So their audience was like younger kids. So obviously like no violence, no like.
Let me time out real quick. I just realized right now, anybody watching, my mouse pad that I'm using that just painted for me for my fan, my big time fan years. So Joe, that's how big of a fan I am and was and am, you know, so good luck. I wish him all the luck over there. Okay, go ahead. So you were saying Teen Titans Go.
Teen Titans Go was, I think, their audience. It was more for like a younger audience, because it was on Cartoon Network. I don't know if the regular Titans was on Cartoon Network. I never watched that one, but that was
regular Teen Titans.
Yeah, Teen Titans. I think that was an animated one as well.
Yeah,
so I never watched any of that one, but I probably would have. But
there's even a movie I think on HBO Max that's Teen Titans versus Teen Titans Go. Do you know the difference, Monkey, between the two shows? Okay, I don't think Monkey does. He has no.
Yeah, so the Teen Titans Go was funny and, like I said, geared more towards a younger audience. You know,
like they kind of have like more of an animated show from Cartoon
Network. Right, I do think, yeah, like.
So y'all think maybe one was more geared towards kids?
Yeah, more geared towards the younger kids, like the Teen Titans Go. So I think it was more about like them living together and like the fun aspects of them being and like. Their rivalries. I forget their rival team or whatever. And then the Teen Titans, the regular one, was more like they're like teenagers almost.
Okay.
So like the Teen Titans Go was more like they were kids, you know, like just kind of figuring out themselves and you know.
So I don't mean to interrupt, but I just looked at HBO Max. I wanted to see Teen Titans is on there, but Teen Titans Go is not on there.
Right.
So I don't know. And this is also funny because I was recently looking for the new Swamp Thing show. DC had done a new Swamp Thing show. And I thought everything DC was now on HBO Max, but apparently not because Swamp Thing wasn't on there. It's still on the Peacock or CW. It's on one of those or whatever, but they cut out some of the words. So I plan to just probably buy a copy. Anyway, there was a Teen Titans and a Teen Titans Go. And I think there was even a movie that was Teen Titans versus Teen Titans Go, whatever. I'd seen parts of those. Each, and I liked them. I thought they were cool. Now, in my understanding, and again, any of my DC fans out there, please correct me if I'm wrong, but those teams are led by Robin. That is the Tim Drake Robin.
Mm-hmm. In the Teen Titans Go one, like okay. He's like the leader. Tim. And right. And yeah.
So this is the third Robin, and this is the youngest of the Robins, I believe. And I believe he may be the current Robin, although I know that there is in the comic books, there's a Batman son who's been in some of the animated movies named Damian Wayne. And he is
see, I don't know.
Robin as well. Yeah, there's apparently there might be two Robins running around right now.
There's several Robins.
But my all-time favorite Robin and one of my favorite characters, and this show definitely helped to develop that, and that's what we're gonna talk about tonight again, is the live action Titans show available on HBO Max. We both watched all of season one. You're almost done with season two.
Right.
I'm done with season two and caught up to the current episode in season three.
Which I would highly recommend.
There's only four episodes in on season three right now. The fourth one, new episodes come out every Thursday. They dropped three at the beginning of the season, and then they did one. It's one after, so it's going to be one. So they just did one Thursday. You can easily catch up. So, super fucking fun show. And like I said, you know, that trailer was cool at DC Fandom. And I was like, man, but I'm not going to become a member of the DC app to watch that. But I was like, it seems cool. Mm-hmm. So I would ask my DC guys, like Albert, and I mean, I'd be like, hey, do you know, are you watching Titans or whatever? And he's like, nah, I don't have that app or whatever. But he always like bootlegged shit. So I thought maybe he had bootlegged Twitter. But
Albert.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool, that whole fuck Batman line. And for, you know, the good thing was cool. By the time it got to HBO Max, I'd kind of forgotten about it.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, it was our uncle, mine and Amy's uncle, Bill. I met his friend, his partner at work, Joey, at oddly enough, sadly, at my grandma's, I guess you kind of call it a wake when we were at the house afterwards.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you call that a wake, but, you know. Anyway, there I met him. You know, he came out to support my uncle, and I got to meet him, and we started talking. And he was saying that he was a DC guy, and his wife was a Marvel guy. His wife's name was Amy. And he was saying that, you know, there's things that they've watched, his wife tend to lean towards those. But what he really loved, he goes, like, have you watched Titans? And I was like, I haven't, man, but I remember that came out. And he was like, oh, man, you got to watch it. And I think he might have been the one that even told me that it was on HBO Max. Okay. So I was like, okay, so. I looked it up, and like you guys know, I watch stuff during my lunch. Again, I watch it all on my phone, but I would love to rewatch it on the
TV. He says during his lunch, but I think he's lying.
During my lunch. Or in the morning, sometimes when I'm brushing my teeth. So I started to watch it, and I got one episode in, two episodes in, and then I kind of dropped it. No, I got about, I think, a half an episode in, or an episode in, and I dropped it. And I was like, you know what, I had other stuff to watch. I didn't get to the podcast, mm-hmm. What's going on. But then I decided to pick it back up because I had saw the trailers for season 3. I was like, I got to pick it back up because I want to see if I can finish it by then. And I think the episodes are what, 45? They're not a full hour.
They're like 45 minutes.
It's not a full hour. It's like
a full hour, but I feel like they don't drag, but I feel like it's an hour. Like, I mean, we're 15 minutes away, you know? I'm just like.
Well, but see, me and AA have talked about this where I feel like the Marvel shows, Mandalorian, like, you know, they've gotten in this really sweet spot where about 45 to 48 minutes is a great amount of time.
Yeah,
you know,
I feel like I think the episodes are like 45, 46 minutes.
Okay. Okay, so anyway, they're in that sweet spot. I start watching it, and then once I get a little bit deeper in, maybe episode, maybe even just two or three, season one, mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, damn, this is really good, whatever. Like, I was like, good action.
Right.
I think pretty good acting. You know, for the most part, yeah, good acting. The a little bit of the dialogue could be tightened up.
But yeah, I agree.
I have enough of a knowledge base of the characters that I was like, I'm willing to go with this. Now, long before all this, I'd always been a Dick Grayson fan. I always liked Dick Grayson. And, of course, in the comic books, Dick Grayson becomes Nightwing. And I really dug the Nightwing character. And the more as I got into the lore of Batman, and I know that oftentimes me and AA on this show get accused of kind of like taking a shit on Batman, although we're all decked out tonight.
Because I love Batman.
And again, we love the movie Batman. We love Batman, the animated series Batman. I would say that maybe it's some of the animated movie and the comic book Batman. And when they always want to make Batman this, like, equal to Superman, or they want to make Batman this, like, he's the Reed Richards or the Tony Stark of the DC world. I'm like, why? You're not a doctor? Like, Reed Richards is like a fucking, like a scientist, like a legit doctor or whatever.
He's a billionaire philanthropist.
Right, right. Okay. So now they don't even give him the background of Tony Stark has or whatever, you know what I mean? But, you know,
I mean, he's still really
smart.
It
is what it is. Let me get these comments real quick. Joe says, Teen Titans Go was especially good for kids because that was the one more for kids. Joe says, yes, by now Dick is Nightwing. And this time he says, Damian Wayne, especially in the animated movies, is great. And Joe, great suggestion. Joe told me to watch Teen Titans versus Justice League, the animated movie. And I'm watching that right now. And again, I feel like that one leans on the new 52 versions of the characters. Is that right, Joe? I'm not really sure if that's what they're called, but I noticed the Superman looks younger and things like that. But it's good so far from what I'm watching or whatever. I like what I'm seeing thus far. Although I really hate the Damian Wayne character and he's a dick. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about Titans the show. So, sis, so you start to watch it. I'm already in love because I'm like, okay, the primary character seems like it's gonna be Dick Grayson, you know. But he's Robin still.
Right.
He's in the Robin persona, but he's not with Batman. He's soloing it. And we also see, well, we're not calling her Raven yet. They're calling her Rachel. But we know that she's Raven. Because, you know, it helps that we have a familiarity with the characters, but you don't need that to watch the show and enjoy it. But you see the Raven character.
You don't need that to watch the show, but knowing who the Titans were and, like, I was expecting those characters.
Their personalities?
Just like, you know, well, I know that Starfire
right.
is an alien. And I know that Raven, I know that her dad is a demon.
Okay.
You know, so she's not.
I don't think I even knew that much.
Yeah. And so they actually.
I was pretty blind.
In the Teen Titans Go, you know, it's a funny one because, mm-hmm. you know how Raven is. She's supposed to be like, in this show, in the Teen Titans Go, Raven is very like. She's like, you know,
dark goth,
and like,
leave me
her
alone,
dad
like,
always wants her to be bad or whatever.
Okay.
And he comes up for whatever.
Do they show him?
Yeah, they show him.
They call him Trigon?
I don't know. I don't remember in the
okay.
two nights ago, but she's always telling him like, dad, like leave, like you can't be here. Like you're supposed to be, and he always wants her to like come join him. And she's like, no, like,
okay.
It's funny in that sense. So yeah. I had already known that because I had watched the Teen Titans Go. Like I said before, so but just knowing that I was hoping that that's how it would go. And that's how it was. Like, Rachel's dad is from the underworld, or from hell, wherever you want to call it. He's a demon or whatever. And you know.
So clearly they borrow heavily, or not borrow, but they are using the essence of the character. But obviously it's in a more adult setting, obviously.
Oh, for sure.
Because number one, guys, they're swearing like a motherfucker in this show. Like, there's the gloves are off on that. There's blood, you know what I mean? And there's...
I don't want to say sex, but you...
Yeah, there definitely is. Yeah, I mean, they don't show, like... Well, no, in that one scene, they show some tits. In that one scene, they're in the strip club or whatever. I know they show
some hot butt cheeks, and I was like...
I was going to say, yeah. Okay, so as you're watching it, like, you know, again, so I had one guy reach out to me by messenger on Facebook or whatever from the group. Not in our group, but I don't know where it was. But anyway, I tried to message back, and it was like, said he was deleted or something. Weird. But this guy was like, Titans is fucking stupid. He was like, Titans is supposed to be a show for kids, blah, blah. And I was like, are you new, bro? I was like,
come on, that's where they have Teen Titans Go.
I was like, that's like saying, like, Spider-Man's it's a comic book for kids. And like, they make everything for grown-ups now. Fucking dolt.
Anyways,
so what did you see next on the, in the?
So I think right away they introduced, Corey, which is Starfire.
Mm-hmm. Coriander, which sounds like.
Which at first I was like, because in the cartoon she's not African American.
Yeah, she's orange.
Right.
Yeah.
And you're just like, but right away I knew who she was because she has magenta hair.
Yeah.
And I was like, at first I was like, I don't know. You know, what's funny is that me and Kara were actually talking about this the other day. We were talking about how they have the Disney movies, and then they make the live action movies, and they cast sometimes different characters. And they're getting ready to do a live action Little Mermaid movie, and the actress who's going to play Ariel is African American, which I have no problem with, except for the fact that I'm more of the type of person that wants to see it like, I think we've had this conversation too. I want to see it the way that I saw it growing up. Like, had Ariel been an African American at first, and then they cast a white person or a white female, I'd have been like, well, what are you doing?
Okay.
And that's kind of how I feel now. I'm like, well, you know, an African American with the red hair and the mermaid, like, you know, that means Triton's gonna be an African American too, which is totally fine. But I'm like, who is it gonna be? Who's that? Who we're gonna cast as her that's an African American? And like I said, had Ariel been African American in the Disney movie, I wouldn't have no problem with it.
Yeah.
But she wasn't. That's like casting Tiana from Princess and the Frog now in a live action movie as a white woman. That doesn't work. Like, that's not the way that I would want to see it. You know, I would like it to be based on how I grew up. I love The Little Mermaid. It's like one of my favorite movies.
Yeah. I think what I hear a lot of people say sometimes, they're like, oh, don't change a classic character. Like, instead, why don't you use an already existing character of that race and like build that character up or whatever.
Right.
But, you know, I have to admit that sometimes just when you look back at a lot of these superheroes and a lot of that, it's like, it is very, in a way, whitewashed. So it's like, you know, you have to add diversity. I mean,
well, yeah,
like,
no.
You know,
and
it's
then like,
if you look at the Avengers faces, if you look at the Justice League's faces, it's like, there's no other races. I mean, and I would like to see like Latinos represented.
See, I did like when they did, you know, I don't know if, well, Cyborg is, he's African American, right?
Uh-huh. That's always been,
But back to Starfire, where her name's Corey in the show, right away I knew who she was. And of course I was like, oh my God, it's Starfire!
Yeah.
Because automatically you know who she is because she has the magenta hair and in the cartoons and in the other shows.
Plus it kind of works because she can kind of walk around as a human. If she was walking around orange, it would be like,
Right. Like, although I think, working? I don't know, maybe in her, where she's from, they can change and be.
And I think it was kind of controversial when that first came out. You weren't the only one to say that. That was part of the controversy, is that like, oh, like, you know, they cast this African-American girl as Starfire.
I mean, it didn't bother me that much, but right away I was like, she's not,
and even then, you know, number one,
something that did come
number one
mind.
She's super freaking beautiful or whatever.
She really is. She's one of my favorite characters.
Me too. And if they would have, and definitely one of the most powerful, I think. And if they would have, if they could have just made her orange. Now what I do like is when she kind of uses her powers at full, she kind of just turn orange in a way, which
does.
Is neat or whatever, you know. And she does a great job, I think. And again, that character is very, from what I've seen of the cartoon, the kitty cartoons, is, and I've never read any of these comic books, so I'm not familiar with them, and I've never watched any of the DC animated movies about the character, so all I really have as a frame of reference is the Teen Titans or Teen Titans Go, whichever one I was watching. And she kind of always is kind of like this, like, ditzy, like, ethereal, like,
in the Teen Titans, because she's not from Earth.
She's kind of always
so
out of
she's very, like, fairy like goddess like
yeah,
whimsical,
right?
Doesn't
right.
know
from Tamarind, right? Tamarind's her planet.
Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, this Corey is just a fucking badass. Like yeah. I'm like, she's like bad bitch status all the way. Like I'm like, man, she's fucking cool. Like yeah, she kicks ass cool. right away. Like in the early episodes. Let me read a couple questions right here. Comments. Joe says, yes, he says Damon is a badass. Disagree. He says, yes, he comes out. I'm not sure what we're talking about there. He says, the first trailer was the big fuck Batman quote out there. Yeah, that wasn't the one. Oh, Andrew Ever Benitez says, Nene in the house.
What's
says,
up,
Nene? What's up, Nene? Where's Angel at, bro? Is he here? Is he here today?
Hey, it's the rainbow emoji for me.
I was gonna say, man, Angel, man, I wanted you on last week, bro. I was trying to get you to come on the show, but yeah. you were too busy. So I don't know if you're still out there, bro. But I appreciate you popping in to say hello. Holty Bear in the house says, "What up, Holty Bear? What up, my man? Welcome, welcome, welcome." I appreciate you joining the show, Holty. I know that you started watching Titans also based on our suggestions. So if you have any comments to add in regarding Titans, please let us know, man. I'd love to hear what you have to say about it. Did you have any base of knowledge or familiarity with the characters before watching the show, or you just went in kind of blind? Jason, I'll get that comment in our next break for sure. But yeah, so I've seen Corey. She's a badass. So we kind of mm-hmm. get those three. We start with those three.
Yeah,
right?
So you got Dick Grayson, which is Robin.
Mm-hmm.
You see that he's a police officer, you know,
a Detroit detective.
Like, going on? Yeah, he's a detective,
which is kind of cool. It's like, oh, he went and just got a regular job,
yeah,
doing law the right way.
Robin thing in nighttime,
he's not doing law the right way,
yeah. Well,
yeah, and we see that
justice is served different ways,
right? And Rachel's having these kind of dreams, right, about the flying Grayson,
right? She's having a dream about Robin, you know, when he was younger, what happened to his family, which I don't know. Was that in the comics?
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
that's,
yeah.
That's 100% his origin.
Oh, okay. So his I really like that aspect of kind of giving. I really love when they give you a backstory. I think we talked about this before, mm-hmm. too, is that I always like to know that person's backstory or that superhero, whatever it is, whoever it may be. But I did like that. Mm-hmm. I'm reading the comments.
Yeah, I know. Sorry, don't get caught in the comments. I'm like, Kevin, they also Kevin Smith on his podcast.
But yeah, I so we got Corey, we got Rachel. Rachel's living with her mother, trying to live a normal life, and she's having these dreams about Dick Grayson. And you're just like, okay, who's this? You know, why is she having dreams? And of course, right away, I knew that she was Raven because she had the purple streaks in her hair.
Right. But they never call her that.
And, no, her name's Rachel, yeah. which is close to Raven.
And she's kind of seeing, like, these, like, demonic shit, right?
Yeah,
it's like a heavy, you know.
Like a persona of herself in the mirror,
yeah.
you know. Like,
yeah.
Like her true self, in a sense. And that's what I'm thinking, you know. Like, okay, that's really who she is. But obviously she doesn't know yet,
right.
you know, that she's part demon.
Right. And it's kind of scary or whatever. And I mean, and I think her mom gets killed, right? In the very
her
first episode.
Her mom
gets
killed, a man comes for Rachel,
mm-hmm.
and her mom gets murdered in the process. And Rachel attacks the man, and the man actually has a tattoo of a raven in the back of his shoulder.
Right. That's right. I forgot about that.
And you know, they don't know who he is or why he's there or whatever, but he ends up killing Rachel's mom, so she flees because she's like, "What the fuck?" You know, she's
yeah.
afraid, and she hops on a bus to the first place, and she goes.
Yeah, you know. And even then, like, in the bus mirror, she's seeing these images or whatever.
Right, because, well, again, she doesn't know. She's like, my mom just got murdered by some fucking guy that yeah. I've never seen ever.
And I think she knows that she kind of has to find this, kind of find Grayson. In
right, because she's like, you know, I'm having these dreams of this boy,
mm-hmm.
you know, I need to find him.
Mm-hmm.
So I think he's in there in San Francisco, right? He's in San Francisco? Or?
No. He's a Detroit cop.
Detroit,
at the
okay.
Or
so I think she goes to Detroit, right?
I can't remember exactly where she goes, whatever, what happens in that part, but they do meet up.
Yes. Well, because
like
she gets
in
episode
two, maybe?
She gets arrested for something, I think, and she's there at the police station,
mm-hmm.
and he gets to meet her, and she's talking to him, and she's telling him, like, you're him, you're.
Yeah.
You're the boy, whatever, from the circus. And he's
right.
like,
how do you know that? Yeah.
You know, what's going on? And, you know, and he, of course, right away, he's like remembering. And he's like, what the fuck? And he's like, you know, I think he asked her, like, you know, who sent you or something like that. Or,
right.
You know, what's going on or whatever. And she's telling him that she needs help. And he's like, you know, he can't help her, you know, because he's like, weirdo.
Yeah. And what we're seeing of Corey this far is, like, she wakes up in a car without no memory. So she's like, who am I? I don't know.
And then she gets in a car accident, actually. And there's a...
That's right.
She's with a man in the car. She gets in a car accident. And when she comes to, she has no memory of what she's doing or who she is or where she's at. And she gets out of the car all discombobulated. And then there's another car coming with men shooting at her. And she's like, what?
Yeah.
And... I think she flees.
And then at some point in her trying to kind of discover who she is, or she ends up having to fight these guys, and she finds out that she's a badass. She's like, oh shit, just like,
yeah, like it's coming naturally.
I kicked ass. Like, yeah. So that was like something cool. That's like I said, you find out right away that she can kind of kick ass, whatever, and she's pretty badass. I don't think she's really using powers at that point.
Well, no, because I don't think, she's unaware at this point, but she does have some like good, like, jujitsu, karate.
Yeah. So is it into episode one, sister episode two, that we kind of get a glimpse of Gar? You know what I mean? Of...
I think that might be in episode two.
Okay. So like right at the very end. Yeah,
I think and then they show him in the woods.
You see the green tiger, you know what I mean?
I think that might be at the end of episode one.
Yeah.
And then episode two, it shows us more of him.
And I forget why they show that. Maybe they're like, they're traveling along and they get there or whatever. But yeah, know, that's kind of like, and you kind of, if you know, you know. You know, most people saying that, right? If you know, you know. You kind of pop because you're like, oh shit, like, that's Beast Boy. Like, that's the Green Tiger. Boy, you know what I mean? Like, that's neat.
And as soon as I saw the Green Tiger in the woods, I was like, that's my boy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and Beast Boy, if you guys don't know, you know, I don't know, a lot of people probably didn't watch Teen Titans Go or Titans because they're for kids. Those shows, because they're animated, are geared more toward kids.
Yeah, I think you'd be surprised. I think a lot of times parents are watching with their kids.
Right.
That's how. I know that I had to have watched the Teen Titans Go with Kal-El. That's who I saw it with. So that's how I knew. Whatever.
But... you should try to catch a couple of Teen Titans Go episodes.
If I can find it, because it's not on HBO Max. That's right. It says that they have the regular Teen
Titans. I even have Hulu. I can catch it.
I'll definitely check it out because I remember watching them and thinking that they were funny.
It's funny. Yeah, it's funny. You know.
Okay, so you know. We don't have to take people through the paces of episode by episode. Me and Double A sometimes get caught in this or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's like, there's, you know, let's move it along. So far you're saying, let me ask you, what are you thinking thus far of, like, let's talk about Brenton Thwaites and his portrayal of Dick Grayson. What do you think?
So.
Really handsome guy, I think.
He's obviously a handsome guy. But I did see some of his fingernails in the shots of the movie.
Really?
In the show. Okay. And I was like, what's going on there?
Were they rough from fighting?
I don't know, maybe, but it wasn't cute. He's a good looking guy overall.
I think he's a very handsome guy.
I think he has a lot of anger management issues. Obviously, the character, you know, Dick Grayson, and it's obvious that it's geared towards Batman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because they're doing a lot of flashbacks of when he was younger, and he's like running away. He doesn't want to be there at the mansion at the Wayne Manor, and you know, he's against it, and he wants revenge, and. I mean, who wouldn't? You're a kid that just lost their parents in this tragic accident, and then you find out that they were murdered
by mob asshole or whatever.
Right, and then this, you know, billionaire wants to take you in because you're an orphan now. I mean, it's a lot for...
Which is kind of weird, too.
Right, you know what I mean? A lot. A kid his age, what was he, like 12?
Maybe 12, 13.
Like 12? Yeah. And, you know, it's a lot to take in. And
you also don't, in these flashbacks, and of course, you know, I think in anybody's mind that's a fan of this, and I'm going to cut you off, but you're thinking to yourself, like, are we going to see Batman? Are we going to see Bruce Wayne? Like,
every single episode, I was like, am I going
to? That's what I was kind of thinking. Not because I wanted to, because I was.
I wanted to see him.
I liked the idea. Well, I did too.
I was hoping that it was Christian Bale.
I did too. I wanted to see him. I didn't think that at all. In fact, what I thought was, and I thought was going to be cool, and we kind of will get there at the season finale, is the one, is that I thought we were going to get, like, and I kind of like this, because I kind of like what they did in Shazam, where that you just see, like, oh, this is my buddy, and you just see the neck down.
The shadow.
And it's the suit. You see the whole suit, but then, like, the hands on the trigger, like, that's all you need, right? Like, to me, if I would have just seen, like, a thing rise up, like a cowl or, like, a silhouette, I would have been like, oh, that's pretty badass. Like, it's neat that they play with that.
They did do that.
And I like that when they play with that. And they even played with that with Bruce Wayne, where you just see, like, there's, like, a man there or whatever. And I was like...
Well, yeah, because, like, in one of the episodes, you know, Dick ran away when he's younger.
Right.
And they show Bruce in the... in the window, but it's just a silhouette of him. Yeah. And you're just like, oh my God, he really is there.
Yeah, yeah. And but I like how they play with that, because that kind of is like, and again, it's not like you're waiting for this reveal or whatever, because I'm getting into the character. And again, like I said, I've always been
interested. I'm waiting for the reveal. See how we think.
Yeah.
I'm into the show, but I want to see Batman.
I think a lot of people have like always thought like Robin was kind of like a little
something. I know, so. I see him playing.
Get it. Get it. Like a little gnat. They've always thought that, like, you know, Robin was like a lame, and like, you know, Robin was whatever. But I think in the animated series, they start to make Robin cool. And as Robin progresses into becoming the Dick Grayson Robin, progresses into becoming Nightwing, I feel like Nightwing is his own fully fledged character. Like, I feel like he could be a Justice Leaguer. I feel as though he is the better version of Batman. And I'm going to get into what it is and the things I don't like about Batman. And this is why. And again, see, I don't think that you know enough about the Nightwing character and
Robin, well,
but you're getting a, this is a good getting a taste of it or whatever.
I just feel like you're putting Batman down here and he should be up here.
I'll tell you why. But we're almost at a break. So let's just take the quick break now.
Yeah.
And then we'll see if there's any comments and we'll get back into it. Guys, let's put the commercial here and say, so you're going to hear a quick commercial break from me, and then we'll come back. So it'll be either in this spot or you'll have heard it in the previous spot, so we'll find out.
And cut.
All right.
You are about to participate in the most ambitious culinary experiment ever imagined.
This competition is going to test everything.
Adapt quickly to anything. I mean anything. The wildest day of your life starts right now.
All new 24 and 24 Last Chef Standing. Sunday night at 8 on Food Network. Stream on Max.
All right, guys, thanks for hanging out through that break. If you're listening to us on Facebook Live, a really late one, we're getting, we got through.
Y'all are up.
A brief it's run Friday. Of comments. It's Friday, right? Why aren't y'all drinking? We know Jason's got Big Red. Joe's got Mexican candy shots.
Jason, put a little vodka in that Big Red.
Jason says, I got to look at my Longhorn, Hook'em Horns, and my Texans. Okay, right on, brother. I'm glad to hear that you're a Texans fan. I get that if you live in San Antonio, because Houston is closer. So geographically, it makes more sense. For the Cowboys fans out there, I don't get it, but whatever. Guys, but we're talking all things Titans tonight on HBO Max. Two seasons out in full, and then we've got a couple episodes into the new season, and Steve does confirm Texans and Cowboys. Okay, Steve. I agree with one half of what you view. I know how you feel about the Longhorns, Steve. That's how I feel about the Cowboys.
At least you got the Texans, right?
So, you know what
I mean? I'm messing with these men's but, teams now.
Neither one of those are my team, whatever, because I went to Houston to watch the Patriots play and see Tom Brady play, and they beat us. I go to Houston one time to see the fucking Patriots play and Brady, and they lose. The Texans get a win over the Patriots. I'm like, what, the Brady Patriots? What the fuck? So, anywho.
Maybe he let them win.
Moving on. Maybe. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Anyway, guys, we'll talk more about that in our next break, but right now we're talking Titans. Number one, we both agree that it's a super killer show, but we have different
highly recommended guys
opinions on what that. So moving on, we get some characters that I knew nothing about. I don't even know if these characters exist in the cartoons or the comic books. Joe or one of my DC guys helped me out. Hawk and Dove.
I think Hawk, but maybe I'm wrong.
I had never seen or heard of them. And now again, I am admittedly a very like Justice League level only DC fan. When you start to get deeper in there, I know some of them like as a joke, me and Albert joke about it. My other DC guy, like Booster Gold and Blue Beetle. And I didn't think that Blue Beetle was cool at all. I was like, wow, what a piece of trash character. These guys don't compare to Marvel at all. But in the movie that Joe had me start watching today, Justice League versus Teen Titans, in that one, it's a new Blue Beetle who's a Latino, and his suit is like an alien scarab that almost acts like a symbiote. And so then I was like, okay, number one, he's a Latin guy, so I like that. I believe his name is Javier. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong. It might be Javier. I might be fucking that up. But either way, I was into it right away. I was like, this is cool or whatever. So I was like, I'm with that Latino version of the Blue Beetle because he's
and
a
it's
Latino.
A show.
This is the DC animated movie. Now, when it comes to DC and animation, sis, except now with What If, they really kill it. Like they have really good like hour 19 minute movies that are good. Like you watched Killing Joke.
I did because I had actually had been seeing it. It was on what, Netflix? It was on Netflix.
But now it's on Max.
Right. It was on Netflix for a long time, and I had been seeing it. And then it was like, it was coming on, it was on TV, and I had caught a piece of it, and I really wanted to watch the whole thing. So I went into Netflix, and I watched the whole thing, and I really liked it. And there's Grogu.
Yeah. But watch some of their other ones. Like Flashpoint, you will love that one. That's the one I told you where something goes wrong, and in the future, it's Bruce Wayne that got killed in the alley, and the dad is Batman, and he, Thomas Wayne, and he uses a gun. And it's badass.
Wow.
And the mom goes insane because of his death, and she becomes the Joker.
Oh, my God. Like, that's, see, when Flash, it's those kinds of, like,
that's Flash
twist
point
on things, I really am interested.
I just watched two episodes of the old Batman the Animated Series that I loved. They have a ninja in them, and I always remember those from being a kid. It's some of my favorites. The Batman the Animated Series is so strong. I told you to watch that to get familiar with the comics, because the Clayface episodes are some of my favorites. The Mr. Freeze, for sure, and those the animated ones.
The Batman. Or just Batman.
It's called Batman the Animated Series. Okay. It's on HBO MAX. And AA was just something I did that he's been watching, what he's been binging during his time.
He's gonna be all caught up on all kinds of stuff.
The Superman animated series, which is kind of came after, but they did it the same style, and it was also very excellent. But after that also came I think they did Justice League and Justice League Unlimited, and there's great episodes in that. Joe had me watch this really fantastic episode called Epilogue. And if you watch it, you'll be like, if you were ever familiar with Batman Beyond.
That was like animated.
That was an animated one.
I think I might have watched it.
An all-new guy in the future named Terry McGinnis, and he was an all-new Batman or whatever. But in that show, Bruce Wayne is there, but he's old, like he's elderly, but he kind of trains him or whatever. But there's a very, very nice thread in there, and it's a beautiful part. Let me tell you the part that Joe likes to tell, because he's told this on his show a couple times. But there's a scene in there or whatever where there's this team, they're attacking or whatever, the Justice League, right? And the only person that can go in there and save them is Batman. Well, to disarm the main villain or whatever. Okay. She's got a team. They're kind of like King's Court, like off with their heads. They're like, that's their little gimmick or whatever, but they're like destroying the world. And she has powers of like reality manipulation. So she's making like, it looks like cards and all this shit or whatever.
Okay. Right?
So they're like, what's your name? Comes from Suicide Squad, Amanda Waller. She comes in, she's like, Batman, you got to go in there and you got to like take her out. And she's like, are you willing to do that? Because I know you don't do that. And he's like, well, in this case, I got to do it because it's, you know, the only way or whatever. So when he gets to the little girl or whatever, and of course he's Batman, so he knows stuff. We're getting way off topic. We're sidetracking podcasting here, podcast moment. But she says, I know you're not going to kill me with the weapon that they gave you. And he's like, you're right. She goes, you're going to try to convince me to just stop what I'm doing and turn the world back the way it was. And he goes, that's right. And she goes, it's because I'm dying, right? And he goes, yeah. She has like a tumor or whatever that's killing her. And so then she asks him, she's like, will you stay with me until my time comes? And he says, yeah. And so then he comes out and he's carrying the body or whatever. And she turns everything, you see everything turn back to normal or whatever. And so then that Amanda Waller goes, that's when I knew that like Batman had a heart or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, you know,
who wouldn't think Batman didn't have a heart though?
Okay, so there's a lot about Batman that I don't agree with. And I'm going to tell you the main thing, and it's a factor in this Titans show that is one of the things I don't like about the Batman that we see kind of in some of the animated movies. Definitely in that Green Lantern series that I read with AA, that Rebirth, whatever. Okay, so in the Batman, and even in the one I'm starting to watch right now with that Joe gave me, Batman, Justice League vs. Titans, sometimes Batman be up on like this high horse, in my opinion. He'd be up on this pedestal. And he also be wanting to be like Mr. Loner all the time. When I'm like, you have good people that love you. That's a team, including Clark, including Deanna, including, you know, Barry. It's like the Justice League should be like your family. You should care about them. And if you don't, that's fucked up. And even more so, who you should care about more than anyone is the quote unquote Bat family. Alfred, Commissioner Gordon, Barbara.
But Batman's not always Dick like Grayson, that.
Rob. Well,
I feel like he has his moments.
The thing about it is that I always feel, and this is what, I don't know if you're seeing this with the Dick Grayson thing, whatever, is that Dick is the way he is in this show because it's like PTSD. Like, he's damaged by Batman. He needed, Batman's way is like, you have pain. Use your pain the way I use my pain.
Right.
And get your justice. When that's not what Dick needed. He needed, I need a family. I need someone to love me, to be there for me or whatever.
And you're right, but in the beginning, Dick wanted. He said that. He told whoever she was, the counselor or whoever he was talking to, that he wanted revenge. That he wanted. Not saying that Batman should have like, okay, you want it, let me give it to you, but let me show you how to do it in a controlled environment.
But, which is kind of what happens.
But think about Bruce. Think about what he went through as mm-hmm. a child. And, you know, he became what he thought he should be. And that's, well, they joke about it in every Batman thing that I've seen or watched. They say that like, he's not a kid person, but he goes and he adopts a kid.
You know? And that's what I mean. What the hell? And seeing, and again, like, to get deeper into the lore, you know, of it, it's like, it's almost like, and I've said this before from what I've learned in real life experience or whatever, and like with our own parents and their parents, and then where we're at right now, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like with your son. Number one thing in your life should be you put your kids first and you take care of your kids and you make sure that they don't get hurt and nothing bad happens to them. I feel like all Bruce ever does is put these people he loves in danger. It's like, yes, he has the best intentions, but he ends up putting them in danger, and they do get hurt. You know what I mean? And they do get messed up, whether it's mentally or physically. You know what right. I mean? Like, you know, in the comic books, I mean, like, something very specific happens to the second Robin. I don't want to ruin that for you or whatever, if you don't already know, but it's like, you know, and he's always haunted by these things that happen. And I'm like, and to me, I'm angry with him because I'm like, why do you keep doing this to these fucking kids?
But think
like,
about manipulating all the good that using he, them. Think about all the good that he did do for Robin. I mean, he taught him how to defend himself and take care of himself.
Okay.
Go ahead. He didn't give everything that maybe a father figure should have. Mm-hmm. But that's because, like, he didn't know that. He didn't know how to do that. I mean, his dad got murdered when he was young.
But see, I disagree because I feel like a lot of it, like, everyone loves Alfred. And it's so funny because I just read this thing.
Every Alfred there was.
That's it. Every Alfred there was. Now, how do you feel about where Alfred is in this series? Are you that far?
No, they haven't showed Alfred yet.
They've mentioned it, though.
They have meant, I mean, Dick talks about, you know, calling Alfred and talking to him, and okay. he talks to him, but they haven't shown him yet. I haven't got that far yet.
Okay. Okay. Well, then I won't ruin that for you or whatever, but
I mean, I'm going to watch it anyway.
But almost every Alfred in every Batman movie, in every cartoon, every Alfred is always great. There's never a bad Alfred. Now, I didn't watch that show.
You mean, I think in the Batman Begins.
Yeah. No, in all of them. Yeah. That's Michael Caine. Michael Caine is in Batman Begins.
But no, Batman Begins, Batman Beyond, the cartoon one.
I don't remember. Is there an Alfred in that one? Because by that one,
there's always an Alfred.
Bruce is already old. No. Okay, and Batman Beyond.
It must be just the Batman, the cartoon one. Like,
the Batman?
Yeah.
I didn't really watch.
Whichever one was on WB. I don't know. Whichever one was on back in the day. Okay.
Anywho. But Alfreds have always been great, especially in the movies. Me and AA talked about how much we love the Alfred. You got to get this one. All right, guys. New beer we're trying. This one, you can get this here. It's called Stash IPA. It's from here. I think it's in Austin. This is an IPA. We don't like IPAs. We don't drink IPAs. So I know I never get double it. But I bought this when I went to the movies opening in Austin. I wasn't drinking at that time. So I bought it and it went in the fridge and I didn't drink it.
It's been in the fridge about 3 months.
Oh, yeah. We might want to give it like a turn upside down. Don't shake it. But yeah, but see, they did a special one for Kevin Smith's movies probably, and it was called Secret Stash IPA. So it's Stash IPA, but this one is the Secret Stash. So you guys can find this, but it's just called Stash, but they did the Secret because he has a comic book store called the Secret
Stash.
Does
it have weed in it?
I don't think it has weed in it. Let's read some comments because I can see we're getting Joe worked up is what is going on here. Jason says, I used to live in Houston too. Before Untamable Amy was born, right. My dad was a recruiter there.
I was like, when?
We went to Astro.
I've known you my whole life.
I rode a roller coaster. I did not like it. I never got on again. Joe says, I got to catch up on Titans. Joe says, will you sit with me? I'm telling you, bro. I watched it twice because he's mentioned it twice in different episodes. And every time I watch it, I'm like, man, this episode again. I'm like, fuck Joe.
What, from the Titans?
No, the one I talked about with Batman.
Oh. I really want to watch it now. Yeah.
Like, just that episode stands alone, so you can watch it by itself.
Okay.
And it's really good. Bro, he deserves the pedestal of Batman. He says Damian breaks him. That makes him weaker in my eyes. Damian's a bitch. So Damian is his son, since that was he had
right,
a Talia.
Which I didn't even know that he had a son.
The mom is Talia.
I'm not up and up with the Batman genre.
The mom is Talia. You know Talia.
Who is she?
Talia al Ghul. Her father's Ra's
al Ghul. Oh, yeah.
So that's in the comics. That those are characters. That's
oh, okay.
So he's raised by the League of Shadows.
Is that who?
In the movie?
Right. Is that who she's supposed to be?
Yeah, that's who she is. Okay. That's Bane, the one that's with Bane.
She's beautiful, by the way.
In the movie, that actress is beautiful, yeah. And she was in Inception,
Bane
too.
Bane is beautiful, too.
Do you like her in Inception? She's telling Leo, I'm going to kill the kids. I'll just cut their throats. All right. She's like, I'm going to throw them out the window. And you're like,
but she wasn't in the right state of mind.
Bitch, you are crazy. Yeah, because she kept wanting to go deeper in the damn dreams. I'm like,
she was addicted to the drug.
He was like, don't jump out the window. It's real. Whatever. She's like, no, I'm going to jump. You're going to jump with me. You're never going to find the kids. I'm like, what is wrong with you?
She played a good crazy person in that one.
She was extremely crazy. She was crazy in Batman Dark Knight Rises too. So Joe says, Amy is right about Batman and Robin. Wrong. Amy's wrong, Joe. In Robin, Bat sees what he wants to be. And in Batman, Robin sees everything that he wants to be. I disagree. Robin wants to be, Dick Grayson wants to be better than what Bruce is. Better than what Batman is. That's what I see.
And I feel that. I mean.
Joe says, now watch this pod.com. And he says, if I didn't have a show with luck, I mean, Amy would have a show. Joe wants a show with everybody. Give this man a show. Jason says, I live in Fort Bend country. What's up in Fort Bend?
County.
County. Oh, Fort Bend. Oh, you live in now or lived in? I know you're in Always Hondo. Oh, is it Hoppy?
Josh in my face.
So this is supposed to be a big boy, guys, but we don't like IPAs. So
it's definitely cheers. Cheers,
here's
guys.
Here's
to Kevin Smith. It's definitely stouty. Which are, I guess, I'm not a big IPA fan.
No, it's not stouty. It's hoppy.
Oh, yeah. You're tasting the hops. You're right.
It tastes like grass.
It's kind of grassy.
So next time you guys cut the lawn, just grab a big old handful and put it in your mouth like a dip, and you'll be tasting what we're tasting right now.
It's not bad. Okay. But I already have one beer, so.
So I think we've gotten off on Titans, and we're on to like the Batman thing, whatever. But here's what I see in Titans. In this
there would
dick.
Be no Titans if there was no Batman.
I agree. But I see that this Dick Grayson, and I like this is.
I do like this Dick Grayson.
But I kind of like what I've seen of him, and I haven't read that many Nightwing comics, or whatever, or seen that much in comics. But what I know of Dick Grayson in the comics, and even in like the great movie that Joe showed me, which is another one I watch animated. You can watch it by yourself. Excuse me. Batman and Harley Quinn. You got to watch that one. It's him hanging out with Dick, but Dick's already Nightwing. And to me, when I talk Nightwing is like the fully fledged, like, this is my guy, like Dick Grayson becomes Nightwing and he's the fully fledged, he's his own hero. And to me, if I was making a superhero team, I'm putting Nightwing on my team before I put Batman. To me, Batman is a liability.
Because he's old? Is that what you're saying?
No, not because he's old. I mean,
he's a skilled warrior, bro.
He's a skilled warrior. But here's the thing, he creates more broken families. You know what I mean? And you're not that far. Oh, damn it. See, you're not that far yet.
It's okay. I'm going to watch it anyways. I'm probably going to finish tonight.
You're not that far yet, but there's a really good moment where I believe it's in this, or is it in, I've been watching so much Batman shit.
Okay.
But either way, the speech goes like this, where they're telling Bruce, they're like, you know what? You're just like the fucking Joker. Like, you're just like him. Like, you're psychotic. Like, you're a fucking psycho. You're a sociopath. Like, you don't care who you're putting in the line of fire. You're damaging these young people for your own agenda. Because to Batman, it's a war. And the war doesn't stop. No matter what, the battle is what comes first. We have to, like, quote-unquote, end crime. Which is like trying to count sand. It's like, you know what I mean? And to him, it's at the cost of anything and everyone. That is ultimately it. Which to me, this is what always bugs me about him. And in the Batman the Animated Series, I love that Bruce Wayne and that Batman. Like, I'm endeared to him. But I also felt like in the Clayface episodes, in some of the Killer Croc ones, and especially against Mr. Freeze, I'm like, you're the worst hypocrite. These guys just want their revenge on who fucked them over, which is other bad people. But he stops them, locks them up, and then he locks them up.
Yeah, but those guys are killing folks. Batman's not killing them. He's locking them away.
It doesn't change the fact that he's outside. He operates outside the law. He's a vigilante. I'm like,
Yeah, but Gotham embraced him as a vigilante.
Some people in Gotham.
People that matter.
But he's judge and jury. I'm like, you don't operate within the law. In fact, all the time that he's with Jim Gordon, it's like you put Jim Gordon at risk. This guy's a real cop. Like, I'm like, see, you don't know. Like, well, you watch Killing Joke. You saw it happen to Barbara, right? She gets shot in the fucking spine and gets put in a wheelchair. She was bad, girl.
And then the commissioner gets,
you know, traumatized as well. And I'm just like, these are the people that fall in your web of your, like, and like.
I mean, I see your point of view, but
there's an issue I read. There was this comic book called Hey Monkey, you got what's up? In my room, you can go get it. Okay, knock on the door, and it's okay. He says in this issue, the comic book was called Superman and Batman. You know, they always call those two like world's finest, right? Which I don't disagree with because I do love Batman. But in this issue, for a moment, Batman and Superman switch powers. Man, maybe it was animated, I don't know. But they switch powers, right? And Batman, like, almost instantly becomes, like, power crazy. Like, drunk with the power. And he gets pissed off at Clark. And he's like, why do you waste time, like, being Clark Kent and, like, being with Lois? He's like, you could be doing so much more. You don't ever have to stop. You don't ever have to rest. You don't ever get tired or whatever.
Right.
But see, that's not what makes Superman who he is. What makes Superman who he is his humanity, his ability to inspire hope.
But think about any human that would take on those kinds of powers. They would be instantly consumed right away and then maybe realize.
Yeah, but with what? With him, he was like, oh, I could fight crime 24 hours. I could be stopping everyone, locking everyone up, doing everything or whatever. It's like there's he's obsessed, like, to like the point of to a fault. Now I already read your comment, Joe, that I'm such a Batman hater. I'm not. I actually like Batman quite a bit or whatever. He's like one of my favorite DC guys.
But I got three
Batman skins on Fork Knife, as you call it, Joe.
Fork Knife.
So we play when we're hungry, Fork Knife.
Right.
But you know, no, I don't hate him. I feel as though what he didn't do, he didn't protect his kids.
Right.
That's what he didn't do. And to me, that is a big red flag and a big fault.
I mean, it doesn't make him, you know, a bad guy. It just, he didn't do it right.
Yeah. And what
the right way, maybe.
Yeah. What I've seen.
Or the better way.
What
he could have been better.
Yeah. And what I've seen and known of Nightwing is that he tries to not do that. He tries to not do it the Bruce way. He tries to embrace the thing with the family, whether it's with Barbara or Jason or with Tim later on, he tries to embrace that or whatever. Now, what I like in this show, Titans, that I do see is that what he does, though, they do a good job of showing that he is conflicted. And a lot of ways he acts like he does what Bruce did to him.
Exactly. Like
he wants to abandon you. He wants to be a loner. And I'm like, dude, that does not work. Like,
yeah. See, like, and I think that a lot of, in the show Titans that we're talking about, you know,
a little bit,
he is like that. He is very like the person that he hates, that he, you know,
what do they say? You become your father, you become your mother or whatever. Right.
Right. You know what I mean? And of course later on, he's saying that he realizes now that that's how he was being, that he doesn't want to be that way, that he wants to be better.
Mm-hmm.
But then when they're in the tower, we're kind of skipping some episodes.
It's okay.
You know.
No, good. As long as we're talking about the show, then good.
They're in the tower, and he's with, you know, Hawk and Dove and Corey. And, you know, they're like, oh, let's go to the other room to talk. Oh, let's do this. And I'm like, you're doing exactly what they were doing when y'all were Titans.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, if you're not including them. Good point. And that's exactly why all this bad shit's happening. Because you're not keeping the new Titans in the loop, which you definitely should be, because, well, that's the whole reason why you're making them the new Titans.
Yeah.
So they can do things better than what y'all did.
Like, there's never no trust. Like, and I get it. You know, someone might say, oh, well, you're contradicting because, you know, he's not wanting to endanger them. You're saying he doesn't protect people. I'm like, they're already in. You already got them. And you've already given them these skills. And not only
that, but like those Titans that are there, like Rachel, who is Raven, and Gar, who is Beast Boy, and, you know, Jason, who is Robin. Mm-hmm. Those guys, those characters, they already have powers. Like, you can't take those away. Like, even if they didn't ever meet him, you know, the original Robin, which is Grayson, they still have those powers. Like, that's who they are.
Except, like, well, the Robin don't have powers ever, but see, so the way
But Jason was already, he had already been with Batman. Like, that was Batman's sidekick, so.
But did you get to see his little dark side with the cops?
Yeah,
that happens already.
With the cops?
Yeah, when they, like,
in the beginning, like, when they first show him?
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, and he's just, like, kicking ass because he wants to kick ass.
Yeah, and then he's like, what are you doing? He's like, that's not... Bruce wouldn't allow.
Yeah, and he's like, he doesn't do whatever I want.
He's like, he's not here. And see, oh, yeah. Here's the thing too, like what they kind of, the picture they paint in this, whatever, is that when Dick, who's wearing the Robin costume, Alf in the house, yo, what up, my man? He says, oh no, I haven't seen this yet. I gotta bounce. Okay, bye, I'll come back.
No, don't leave, Alfred.
No, man, we're gonna, it's super spoilers in my head. Yeah. I did not say that, so guys, I'm so sorry, super spoilers on Titans. We're ruining the fuck out of it. So, but it's still great, and you'll still enjoy it. And Alpha, yes, all over the place. Believe me, we talked about like last 3 months, not Titans. So everything else, Batman. I'm going off on Batman. Yet I wear his shirt. So, yeah, I own this shirt, Joe. This is my shirt.
That's my curtain.
So, what they kind of portray is that, you know, Dick Grayson is running around. He's still wearing the Robin costume here and there as needed or whatever, but he's a Detroit detective or whatever. So he's kind of mainly doing stuff that way, but he still uses Wayne Tech and, you know, whatever. When he encounters Robin, he's like, what the fuck, new Robin? He's like, yeah, don't you like the new suit, blah, blah. Like, you know, I'm the new Robin. I'm Jason Todd or whatever. And he's like, okay. And he's like, all right, well, when did you start or whatever? And he's like, whenever. And he's like, damn, he didn't even wait a year to get a new Robin.
Yeah, like he says, like, I've been doing it for like 6 months, yeah, or a year ago. I think Jason says, I've been doing it for a year. And he's like, oh,
he later off. And then he even says, he's like, oh, blah, blah. Like, when I drive the Batmobile, he's like, he lets you drive the Batmobile. So it's like you're.
Which I wasn't sure if that was true.
You're like, already seeing some stuff, right? And again, this is the thing that they kind of make it seem like Dick was like, I've had it with you. I'm out. Like, fuck your bullshit, dude. Like, I'm going to go do my own thing. And I think he went to go become like a detective, become like a legit cop. Like, if I'm going to fight crime, I'm going to do it my way. But again, he still uses Wayne Tech and he still wears the Robin costume at times when needed. You know what I mean? And apparently he had some time that he was working with Hawk and Dove, doing stuff with them to take down criminals. And, you know, again, I don't know if those are actual real DC characters because I've never seen or heard of them, but they're cool in the show. The girl is beautiful.
Yeah.
She's played by Dawn is her name, and she's played by, let me get her name real quick.
CN and
Minka Kelly. Man, is
yeah,
she
she's very
gorgeous.
Beautiful.
Even Rachel makes a reference to her. She starts to let her watch Game of Thrones, right?
Yeah.
And then she's like, okay, Khaleesi, because she's got this really beautiful blonde hair. But you can tell
I think Rachel's beautiful too. I think for
oh, yeah,
a
she
younger,
is. Yeah. Look at her
girl.
Right here. She's not. She's a brunette.
Oh, she's so pretty.
She is a complete knockout. And in fact, when I saw her with Hawk, I was like, why the fuck is this muscle head?
Hey, he's good looking.
Hawk is a good looking guy, but I'm just
really
like,
need to get to that story.
I like Dick better. Dick
yeah,
Grayson's better.
I was, you know, because, you know, you get that feel that Dick Grayson is just like, well, fuck Batman, because he says that. And then I'm like, well, you're here using Wayne Tech, and you're still being Robin.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm like, if you really felt that way, then you would dispose of everything that it was ever affiliated with him. But like you said, he was conflicted, and you see
but
that.
But he's also, like I said, he's also a cop. And to him, it's like, he's still, like, wanting to fight the good fight. And I think he's mainly doing it within the realm of the law. But when the law falls short, he's like, I have these other skills. It's still like fighting the good fight. You know what I mean? Like, right. You know, but not at the expense of like, you're like, I feel like Batman would trade his soul for the fight, for the war. And in this aspect, it's kind of like very Punisher-esque or whatever. Like there's very like Punisher aspects of that or whatever. We talk about that.
You love the Punisher.
And me and Double A's, yes, but he kills. Like, it's like, he's like, I'm all in. I mean, Batman is like, I want to have a code still. And Punisher doesn't work with no one. Like, yeah. it's like this is my war. And I am not only am I judge and jury, but I am also executioner. But there's no one at risk but myself. See, Batman, I feel like he secretly yearns for family or whatever. And I mean, like, he does. I mean,
we know
like,
he does.
Then, you know, but that's what I mean. And it's like, and it
you,
doesn't
you
end
watched
at,
the Lego one, right?
Yes. And it doesn't end with Alfred or whatever. It's like, there are so many other people that you have. Again, they literally call it the Bat Family. There's a new game coming out that I want to buy. It would be reserved. I told you about the Gotham Knights. Okay. You know, the whole premise of that game is that you play as either, I think it's either Jason Todd, Damian, Batgirl, or Nightwing or whatever.
Okay.
Because in the very beginning of the game, Batman dies. So he's like, if you're watching this video, I'm dead. He's like, one of you is, you know, you'll take up the mantle now. This is what you got to do. Mm-hmm. So you get to play as one of them four.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Throughout the Gotham thing. So
that
I was like, what
awesome.
An interesting concept. And again, this show, guys, too, does play with concepts. Mm-hmm. Where it's like, you know, like, it's not like, you're like, wait, what? You know what I mean? Like, what timeline are we in or whatever? You know what I mean? Like, you know, but it plays with some things or whatever.
Yeah.
So, and again, I mean, this is like, again, there's enough. with some of the kind of like dialogue that's a little bit whatever, or sometimes relationships develop really fast. Mm. Without all that aside, there's enough interesting stuff there, I think, regarding the Batman relationship with his Bat family, you know, mainly Dick Grayson, and then how that all trickles down or whatever, you know what I mean? And that's what's going on. Yeah. It's like now Dick is leading a team. Batman never led a team. He was, you know, is a Justice Leaguer or whatever. I mean, but it's like, you know, that's, you know, Superman leads that team. You know what I mean? Like, that's it. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, and a lot of times in the cartoon, he's like, I'm not really like a fully fledged member, blah, blah. And I'm like, well, you know, you always being like, you know, half in, half out. You know, you can't do that or whatever. You know what I mean? You got to be, you know,
all in or not.
Right, right. Because how am I going to trust you if you're not all in? Like, we're a family. Like, we all trust each other or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, yes, there are side conversations that go on or whatever, but for the main part, when decisions are made, it's like we do it together.
Right.
You know what I mean? you know, and it's like sometimes Batman's not like that, because I think, again, now that's what I think he doesn't know is maybe in a sense how to protect, where, and maybe Alfred didn't really teach him that, because yes, Alfred looked after him, made sure he was fed, clothed, patched up his wounds numerous times to the point where he was in tears, where it's like, I'm not going to do it no more.
Yeah.
Like, you need to stop. Like, you need to stop, because he saw, he's like, you don't have love in your life. You don't have nothing, because you're just obsessed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was like, it was breaking him as an old man. And I'm kind of referring to many Batman mythos, which this mainly comes from like the Nolan verse. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But, you know, I feel that Alfred would feel that way, that it would break him down eventually, where he'd be like, man, like, I don't want to see you. I raised you like almost like my own son. I don't want to see you just like used up. Like, you're consumed. You're consumed to the point that you wear a bat costume and run around. Like, you invest all this money in this tech to fight this war and against these monsters. It's funny because sometimes,
when I started watching the Titans, which was just last week, I started watching Batman Begins, because that's my favorite one, the one with Bane.
That's the Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Dark Knight Rises.
Wait, hold that thought. Guys, we're going to take another quick little break on our audio. I'm sorry that I've been crummy about that, but I'm going to be better tonight, and we'll be right back. All right, guys, and we're back. As Joe says, and we're back. But we were just talking, Amy was saying that she just watched the Dark Knight Rises.
I've seen it several times, but I started watching the Titans, so that's my favorite Batman movie.
Christian Bale and Bane.
Right. Well, yeah.
Why do you like that one the most out of those three?
I guess because like Bane gets introduced, and I like the Bane, and I can't think of her name.
Talia. Oh, well, that's or whatever her name is.
Yeah, whatever her name is in the show. Their relationship and their plan.
But you hate Anne Hathaway.
I do. I don't hate her. She's not no. There was no better Catwoman than Michelle Pfeiffer. I don't care what anyone says. Y'all come for me, but there was no other better Catwoman. I mean, and I love Halle Berry, but no, it just didn't happen. Like, and I'm pretty sure a lot of dudes like Anne Hathaway, but she would never be my ideal Catwoman. Like, she wouldn't be my first choice.
I loved her in that movie.
Pfeiffer killed it.
I love that movie. I think that one's my favorite also.
I mean, you know. But I just really love Bane in that one. And I think that's the one where, is that the one where Batman, he goes to the pit?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Bane breaks his back, takes him there, throws him in there. And, you know, he builds his strength back. And he climbs out and he gets out. And I don't know. I just love a lot of that movie, you know. And
But in relationship into Titans, though, like translate, like what were you getting out of that you didn't? You know, like, when it comes to Titans and, like, what we're kind of saying about, you know, how I feel as though, you know, Alfred is, like, a father figure, but he's not a father. Because right. He can't put his foot down with Bruce. Because you're right. Who's going to stop him? This guy's obsessed. You know what I mean? But the thing is that...
I mean, I think Alfred just... He knows that that's not going to change. Like, yeah. Bruce is not going to...
And even all his will... Even all the other, you know, all the other Bat family, they all love Alfred. Everyone universally loves Alfred. You know? I think even in the crummy one that people hate with George Clooney, you know, Alicia Silverstone, you know, well, she plays his niece, I think, in that one.
Yeah, she's supposed to be the Batgirl, niece. Right?
Batgirl? Yeah, Batgirl, yeah. But Batgirl's always been Barbara Gordon, which is Commissioner Gordon's daughter or whatever. You know, but even then, it's like, imagine that. Imagine that. Batman takes on Batgirl. It's Barbara Gordon or whatever. You can say what you want that these kids are. I'm like, dude, you've been working with this man. You bring his daughter into this life. what if the fucking Joker throws acid on her face? And then in that one series, in The Killing Joke, he does. He shoots her through the fucking spine. It's like, and that's not even, as if he knows she's Batgirl. He did that like as a random act of chaos.
A lot of the Bat family wanted to be a part of that life.
But it's his job to say no. So your son might want to go out in the street and play right now in the dark at night. You're not going to let him.
So if I tell him no, what usually happens?
He's going to get upset with you.
Or they go out and do it on their own, and they get killed instead of just hurt.
That's true. But that could happen on Batman's watch, too. Look at what he's engaging them in. He's engaging them in this fucking, with these, like, I mean, again, the Joker is the obviously worst example because he's a complete sociopath. And again, there's something very important that happens that you haven't gotten to yet that is, like, it's extremely key to, in my opinion, Batman's failings or whatever. And when it happens,
well, we established that he failed in many ways, but I think that he also prepared those individuals for the life that they lived while they were under his, you know, direction or supervision or whatever you may call it.
Yeah.
You know, I think that it prepared them in one way or another for the things that they did in their lives, you know, so.
So let's talk about this gentleman real quick who you did get to in where you're at in Titans. But the Bruce Wayne of Titans is Mr. Ian Glenn. Or is it Ian or Ian? But as she texted me when I was at work, she was like, oh my gosh, Jorah is Bruce Wayne. So if you guys are fans of Game of Thrones, yes, the ultimate friend zoned guy by Khaleesi or whatever gets to star alongside.
And he was her best friend.
Yeah, he gets to star alongside another beautiful platinum blonde.
So I kept expecting to see, you know, Batman or Bruce Wayne, and we didn't. And then I was concerned as to who was going to be and if they were going to show him.
Yeah.
I was thinking that they were not going to show him.
Because let's go back a little bit. Let's go back a little bit. Okay. So, and I want to talk about Mr. Glenn, Mr. Ian Glenn, Jorah, who is Bruce Wayne. Is and a good job. But if we back up, all of season one, they don't show.
Right.
You never see.
Season.
Not at all in season one. Because the last episode, and guys, if anything I've said sticks with you or resonates with you, agree with me or don't agree with me. But the last episode of season one is called Dick Grayson. It's the season finale of season one. You could kind of watch it as a standalone if you want, because it takes place in kind of like an outside of normal reality or whatever. Mm-hmm. But that's where Dick is already being part of Trigon or whatever.
Right,
and
right.
He's seeing this vision, and it starts that way. The man is married to a beautiful woman, Dawn, who we saw earlier. We learned that they had a relationship previously or whatever. Mm-hmm. They have a son. He's a detective, I think, and they're in LA, I think, because mm-hmm. it's like all sunny, they're in the pool, and it's like he's got this great life or whatever. Well, then it comes that what happens?
Jason Todd comes to, he's in a wheelchair. He's in a wheelchair, and Dick's like, what the fuck happened to you? And he got shot. He got shot in the back, and he was paralyzed from the waist down. And goes to Dick to tell him that, you know, Gotham's in trouble. Batman's, like, going off the rails. He wants to just be killing, and he's going to kill the Joker. And, you know, Dick's like, yeah, he tells Dick, like, you're the only one that can stop him. Mm-hmm. And Dick's like, what? Like, I'm trying to live my life, living La Vida Loca right now, you know?
Like, I have a wife and a kid now, whatever.
And they have one on the way.
Yeah, and she's pregnant. Super pregnant. Yeah, I forgot about that.
Right, and you know, he's like, I can't go, you know, I mean, he's going to have to just deal with it on his own. And, you know, he doesn't want to go, but then he talks to Dawn about it. And she's like, you know, you need to go. Maybe you really are the only one that can stop him. And
because a lot of people feel like that Bruce Wayne is a father figure to Dick Grayson. I think even he feels that way.
Right.
And I agree with that, but not a good dad, in my opinion or whatever. I did not agree with, and again, this is like
not the best dad.
A dream sequence almost or whatever. But right. It's a very, very strong and powerful, potent episode, I think. And again, if I was ever going to say, people were like, I don't want to watch it, I'd be like, watch this one episode and tell me what you think.
Well, because, you know, he's under the, I guess, control of.
Yeah. It reminded me a lot of one of the episodes of Batman the Animated Series where you have to see, this is another great episode, whatever, but the Mad Hatter is trying to, you know, take over Batman or whatever.
Okay.
So he puts this thing on his head or whatever, and it pretty much, like, it shows you
alters your reality.
So Batman wakes up or whatever, and his parents are alive.
Okay.
And he's, like, he's engaged with Selina Kyle, and, like, his life is perfect, and he's like, what happened? Like, with the, like, at first he's confused or whatever, but then he starts to be like, was the whole other thing a dream, the Batman thing or whatever?
Right.
And so eventually he figures it out or whatever, of course, because he's Batman. And the Mad Hatter is kind of like crying. He's like, why are you mad? He's like, I gave you everything you wanted or whatever. Like you had it perfect. Like you could have had the life that you always dreamed of or whatever. He can't see what he sees because he doesn't know Batman's Bruce Wayne.
Right.
He puts that thing, you just get your perfect life or whatever. And, you know, Batman is like, because it wasn't real. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, ultimately the Batman going to Batman. You know what I mean? Well, I'm just like, thank you, dumb motherfucker. You know what I mean? Batman wasn't like ready to live in the Matrix and be like, after 9 years, this steak, ignorance is
bliss. A false reality. No way.
Cypher did. He was like, this steak is going to be tender and juicy when I bite it.
Fuck.
Not a good example either.
Yeah, I'd be desperate for some.
That asshole, Cypher, ain't eating that gruel every day.
Yeah.
Anywho, so
but
what's up? So Dick decides to go to Gotham, right?
So he goes to Gotham, and Gotham is just toe up. I mean, it's just in all chaos,
which is kind of like always the state of Gotham. Which, if we want to talk about Batman's failures, I'm like, it just continues to be a cesspool.
I mean, it wasn't like the way they portrayed it in the show is not like he did clean up. He cleaned up, but there were still criminals, and it's just really bad. And every part of town is bad. You know, Grayson's in the taxi. He's like, take me here. And the driver's like, I don't go there. Mm-hmm. And he's like, take me here instead. And he's like, I don't go there either. And he's like, well, damn, where can you take me? He's like, I'll take you here. So he goes, and it's a fucking hooker hotel, and it normally isn't. Excuse me. He goes, and he's there. He's there in Gotham, and kind of waiting to talk to Bruce or whatever, go see him or whatever, because he just got there.
Mm-hmm.
He's there, and a woman's getting beat up in the other room. He calls the cops, but they come, and he's something else happens in the midst of that, and I know Don calls him while he's there at the hotel, and Hawk is there helping her paint or whatever because they're having a baby.
Yeah,
and
which is kind of weird. Because,
right, because I'm like, really? And even Grayson's like, really? Like, I've been gone one day. Like, you couldn't wait for me to come back to paint the baby's nursery.
And not only that, but I'm like, this cat went to go live where y'all live? Like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah, so, but again, this is all in his mind.
Yeah, but even then, I'm still like, I guess he's seeing his ideal world. So I'm like, why would he even?
Yeah, so, you know, she's there helping him, and he's like, you know, I'm going home. I'm going to go home. I shouldn't even be here. So he is going to go home. But then the police that are there trying to help the person that's getting beat up get a fucking call on their thing that there is a fucking 2319. And, you know, he's like, what the fuck? I know that. And then he goes out there in the street, and it's Joker. That falls from a building, and he's on a car, and he got killed.
And again, they do a great job, right? Because they don't show you.
They don't show you the Joker's face. They show him he's face down.
But you see, like, the purple suit, right?
Swan dive, purple suit, green hair.
Which is, like, cool. Like, I love this because this, to me,
I thought it was a little cheesy.
So, and I'm going to stop because I'm already interrupting you. But the reason why I say that I like it is because these characters, guys, are already so iconic, and they're so... We're at the point, guys, where we saw a solo Joker movie. I believe that the Joker is the first character, villain, to get his own solo, like, standalone movie, the Joaquin Phoenix one. And
right, which I did love, by the way, but...
How many characters were portrayed by more than one person and won an Oscar? I would like to know that. Because the Joker has two. The Joaquin Phoenix one and the Heath Ledger one. And that just goes to show you the depth of kind of madness that character brings. And then if an actor can tap into that and portray it that way, because both of those portrayals are very, very, very scary and dark. And that character is like that. And so for that to be done, that is extremely impressive to me, whatever.
And
so
it's funny that we're bringing that up, because I just watched the Joaquin Phoenix Joker.
Mm-hmm. Your first time?
Last month for the first time. And I, the Joker was my favorite villain in the DC world. I mean, by far. I mean.
We're so funny. And
Double like I love him.
Me and Double A have talked about this assistant. We said he is by far not the most powerful, not even near it.
But, he's fucking crazy.
But if you talk about power, over the audience wise, he is.
He's easily the top of the
villain food chain in DC or whatever. And it's funny because he's not the strongest, like, at all. He's not like the most.
But he's Batman.
He's not a Thanos in any way. Yeah, he's
Batman's, I think, most.
Yeah, he's first. The complete yin yang. The complete.
And it's funny because the black, you know, to the white, Lego, like, Batman. The white to
black. Yeah. it is like that.
Yeah, you know, the Joker's like, you know. In that one, it's funny because he says that he, you know, he doesn't need Batman or whatever.
Right.
And Batman's like, it's a relationship that they have.
And it's funny because
you know, there's the comics and the movies and the books and the stories and everything. And
their psychosis.
The Lego movie one.
Yeah. Their psychosis is like a mirror of one another.
Right. It's so inaccurately accurate.
Yeah, and I think they kind of touch on it in some of the stuff where it's like they walk a line or whatever. It's like if Batman was.
Well, is that a reference to Walking Dead?
I don't know, but there you go. If Batman was bad, he would just be the Joker, because whereas Joker, if he was
that's his good, arch maybe nemesis. He would
be like they are truly, and that is an interesting dynamic or whatever. Yeah. You know what I mean? And so, you know, people say all the time, they're like, why doesn't Batman just kill him? And then he'll save so many lives, whatever. And it's like, in a way, he can't. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know? And because Joker knows that he lives by this code, it's like he plays with
and
that.
It's funny because in the Batman, in the Lego one, that's kind of how it is. It gives you that, the dynamic of their relationship is that they can't be without each other.
Right.
Like, if there is no Joker, there is no Batman.
Right. In a way. Yeah. And again, see, to me, this is like how he's been wound into his own psychosis, where I'm like, see, the other people, the other Bat family are like, yo, man, like, you're in too deep or whatever, you know? And that's what makes it fucked up for him or whatever. Sorry, it's a chair. You're okay. But okay, so let's kind of fast forward. So we see the Joker die, essentially.
We see the Joker
in this Titans or whatever. But, you know, again, I love it. What I'm saying about it, I love it, is that, you know, how Amy said it looked a little hokey or whatever, which it you know,
that initial part.
They didn't need to show that, because again, right away any fan would be like, oh, what the fuck? That's the Joker. Like, I'm like, oh yeah, there you go. You know what I mean? Although we've been fooled before. But anyway, that's it. So Dick is like
You finally did it, Batman.
Like, he snapped, he broke his code, and he killed. And you know what? It's kind of interesting to me to be like, they play with this a little bit too. Like, when you finally did it, it was that one. This is the one that pushed you over the edge,
right? Yeah,
which to me is the ultimate Joker win. To me, Joker is more obsessed with Batman breaking his code, because for to the Joker, like he says in Dark Knight Returns, the Heath Ledger one,
Dark Knight.
He says, you know, he's like, the worst of humanity will show forward or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, he wants Batman to kill, because he's like, if you're supposed to be the White Knight, you know what I mean, the good, and you kill, then you're just like me, you know, and I'm right, and society is trash, it's fucked,
right?
You know what I mean? So you know, in this they're showing that it's like, again, a dream sequence, but it's like this fall from grace.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Batman has finally crossed the line or whatever. And again, it took one of his kids in this scenario, Jason Todd, to be injured, you know, paralyzed or whatever, which kind of parallels the Barbara Gordon thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? And then he snaps. Okay. You know what I mean? So, and he does what he, you know, finally, who've been him telling them this? You know what I mean? Like, just kill this motherfucker and, like, you'll be done with it or whatever. So he does it or whatever, but in doing that, you lose yourself ultimately, because now Batman, although he's been a criminal all this time because he's a vigilante outside.
I mean, you know.
Right. You know, he's doing good, like the saints, right? The Boondocks, you know, but now that he's killed, it's like, nah, that ain't gonna fly. You know what I mean? Like, that's not gonna fly with the Superman, with anybody, with, you know, with anybody. That's just bad news.
Right.
So then Dick does what? He has to go get him, right?
Right. He has to go get him. He tries to go get him, and
he goes to the Batcave.
Goes to the Batcave. Well, he sends the team in to go get him because he's like, "Hey, he killed the Joker. We gotta go get him.
I know where he's at. I know where he is. That's a cool moment too, whatever, right? So it's like Dick's.
That's not a betrayal.
Dick's not gonna go in solo, whatever. No, because to me,
Even though this is all in Grayson's mind,
yeah.
I'm thinking like nobody would ever give that knows who he is would give up his identity.
I disagree because the reason why is because to me this is, you know how they always say Batman's always prepared, right? Well, Batman always has that kryptonite hidden for in case Superman goes crazy or whatever. What's up?
Sorry guys, we're mild interruption.
Can I yes, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. Knock
sorry.
On the door.
Sorry guys.
That's okay. Yeah.
Sorry. The monkey came in.
The joys of being at home outside the pod lab, guys. But oh, here we go. Regarding to you earlier, he said all he did was help was Batman. Then Joe says it becomes a slippery slope. So here's what I'm getting to you, Joe, is that the way Batman always has his kryptonite in case Superman goes nuts or gets controlled by somebody. That's his ace in the hole. I didn't feel like Dick betrayed him because it wasn't like Dick said.
No, it's just.
It wasn't like he said, I'm going to go in there solo, put my costume on, and go after him. It's like, he's like, in effect, it's almost like he can't do it. It's like, I can't do it, so I'm going to send in like regular cops to go get you because now you've broken the law and I'm letting them know. That's their ace in the hole. That's their kryptonite, in a way, is that like Bruce Wayne is Batman.
Which honestly, like, even though this is in his head, if that was me and I was Robin and he killed the Joker, I'd have been like, good riddance.
Yes, but now you see the problem with it is that once Batman pops that cherry, it's like, oh well.
Yeah, but you does
Penguin,
he think,
Riddler, Freeze, they're all nuts.
They all did bad things. They're all bad guys.
You're not an executioner. What you're doing now is that you're turning Batman into the Joker. He's not Batman no more. Like that's
Joker kills that innocent strips, people. That he destroys innocent lives.
He's the Joker.
Batman, he would be killing just the bad guys.
He's not a jury of their peers. That's not the system.
But anyway, so he sends a team in. To get the Batman, they go in, and obviously it's Batman. You ain't getting Batman in his own fucking house, his own Batcave.
Yeah, his own Batcave.
So he fucks them all up.
He fucks them all up. All the SWAT.
So then Grayson's like, well, damn, I gotta go in now.
Yeah. And you know he fucked up some of them cops. I'm sure he fucked them up.
He fucked them up.
I'm sure some of them can't speak right
now.
He goes in, and
what happens?
They go at it? Or there's an explosion.
No, there's an explosion and Batman. No, so they Grayson sent the team in. They set bombs around the house.
That's right.
Bombs around the house. He's
kind of coaching them. He's like, there's no way you're gonna get in. He's not gonna come quietly. Yeah, he's not gonna come quietly. You can't get out of this situation. Whatever you think is gonna come at you, he's already 10 steps ahead. So Grayson's kind of coaching them in there, which I love this too, because it shows me that I'm like, if someone was going to out-strategize him, it would only be Dick Grayson. That's the only guy I could see doing it, except maybe Alfred, in my opinion.
Yeah.
In all of the Bat family, in all of the superheroes.
Right. So
in that scenario,
you know, they got the bombs going, really just waiting. And,
not Superman. Superman would just fucking dive bomb into there, yank him out, throw him into space, and that'd be that. Yeah. But apparently everyone says not.
So after he just fucking kills everyone, fucking everybody up, that's when Grayson's like, just blow it up. Fucking go ahead, set the bombs off. So they do that. And then after that, he goes in because he wants to see if he's there, obviously. You know.
Yeah.
Obviously the fucking bombs do get him. He's got rubble on him. And he can't get up, and he's reaching out for Grayson, and he's telling him to help him.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, help me, Robin, or whatever. And he's just like, no.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that was the end scene.
Yeah, he, like, pretty much lets him die or whatever, right?
Yeah, because
he doesn't step on him or crush him or anything like that, right? I kind of thought I remember that being in there, that he does, like, take that step further where he's like, you know what?
No, I don't think he does.
Okay.
I think that does happen in
I need to rewatch that episode because I did love that episode. Was the one that I was like,
this right. Show so is CM fucking... really he loved that episode, but I actually loved the episode right before that.
Oh, okay. That's a separate story.
Right.
That's it. So. And again, this show does that sometimes, guys, where it takes you like on like a separate story or whatever, where it's like focusing on two separate characters. They did this earlier, like they focus on the Hawk and Dove character. They introduce them, they show them or whatever.
Yeah, which I like that because then you're getting their story.
Yeah.
And then you get another story and then they intertwine later on. But
And I like that too, because it to me, this is how you make me care about the character. You know, like, right. I don't care about you. Yeah, because when I first saw Hawk and Dove, I was like, well, this looks kind of hokey. Their costumes look kind of hokey. I was like, you know what I mean? Like, I was like, she's beautiful, obviously, whatever. But
you know what I keep thinking about? Dove's outfit is like, isn't it heavy? Like,
it looks heavy or whatever. But, she moves badass in it.
Yeah, she does. But, I mean, I'm sure.
You know,
in real life, they made it like really lightweight, but yeah, it looks like, really heavy.
I wonder if that's if those are comic book characters. I wonder if that's comic book accurate or not, whatever. Because I'm like, wow, they could have made it look more streamlined.
We need to find out about that.
But Joe, you're here with us. Is Hawk are Hawk and Dove actual characters in the DC world, whatever? Joe says that's the Punisher regarding Batman killing exactly, and then he says Batman.
Mames, he doesn't kill.
That means he doesn't kill. Yeah, definitely. But then, and even at that,
in this dream world that Grayson's in,
he snaps.
And then he starts to kill. He is killing.
And again, I do believe that. I believe that Bruce Wayne walks a very fine line, and that the reason why he doesn't kill even one person, even if it's just the Joker, is because that I think that the way he is once he had a taste of blood, he would just keep going.
Joe says yes, Hawk and Dove are, which I figured they were. I didn't think
I figured so too, because I didn't figure like they were doing shit that wasn't in the books. Yeah, but
let's move on to
that episode. Talk. I know you want to talk about it. So
I really like the characters Hawk and Dove. You know, Hank is Hawk and Dove is Dawn. And their story is really cool too, because they just showed that story before they. After they showed Hank's story. But the way they meet is, you know...
So we know that they're a couple already by the earlier episodes. And we also know that at one time, Dawn and Dick Grayson had something or whatever. But then she ended up with
right. Hawk. Which I'm still a little confused about that timeline.
But yeah, that timeline is a little... You know what? I think it'll make sense when you move on. But,
yeah.
But anyway...
Well, actually, first, it is fucked up, but I really love that episode. I think that was the second episode to the ending.
Mm-hmm.
But, excuse me, they do a lot of flashbacks. So Hank has a brother. Excuse me, two different dads, same mom. I know
you wanted to talk about this. Yeah, two different dads, same mom.
Two different dads, same mom.
I'm just going to check my phone real quick, guys.
Excuse me. And, you know, they're showing a flashback of when they were younger.
Mm-hmm.
And they're in school, and Hank's in football, and his brother is younger than him, cheering him on in the bleachers, and you see the coach look back. And at first, this was my first initial thought, bro.
Oh, my God.
My first initial thought was that the coach was racist. Because you see the little boy cheering on his brother, which you don't know his brother yet.
Yeah.
Cheering him on, and you see the coach look back at the little brother, which is he's an African-American. Well, yeah. He's obviously mixed.
Mm-hmm.
Same mom. And he kind of gives a look like not sure look about the kid, you know, like.
Right. Like what
looking
are you,
at him, but then like kind of scared, you know, like.
Yeah.
Like I have a feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, is this motherfucker racist? Because I'll beat his ass. So.
You know what? I think I thought the exact same thing as you, actually.
That was my first initial thought.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, getting a little sipsky there.
That was my first initial thought, and I was like, what the fuck? This motherfucker's racist, like what's going on? But then the practice is over, mm-hmm. Hank's in the locker room.
And how old are these kids, you think?
So Hank's maybe like
10?
10, and his little brother's maybe like
8? No.
7. Maybe like 7?
No, a little bit older. 7 Maybe they're like 12 and 10. Because football practice.
Maybe.
All right. So anyway.
Clips to Hank in the locker room. He's done changing and he's walking out. And he sees his little brother talking to the coach. And he's like, hey, you know, what's going on? What are you doing? And the coach is like, oh, well, I was going to show your brother the fucking workout room or something. The workout room,
yeah.
And right away, you can see in Hank's face that he's like, that's not what the fuck this motherfucker wants to do.
Yep.
And he tells his little brother, we need to leave. Like, mom's waiting for us.
Yep.
And the coach is like, you know, I know that your mom's working late or whatever. It must be hard that you guys don't have a dad and two different dads, but not in your lives. And he's kind of giving this little spiel about knowing their life. And Hank's like, you can see it in his face. He's like, this motherfucker here.
Mm-hmm.
And he's telling the brother, look, we need to go. We need to fucking go right now. So then the coach is like, do you really want me to tell, you know, the other teachers and the principals that, you know, that you guys are cussing and this and that? And he's like, oh, but my brother didn't say anything. And he's like, you know, basically telling them that what I say goes because I'm the adult and they're going to believe me. And
I got,
you.
Yeah, and I got shit on y'all. Y'all cursed or whatever.
Right. So but Hank being the older child.
Yeah.
Is like, you know what? Show me the locker room, whatever. Show me the workout room.
And that's fucking part. This whole,
yeah,
that was
I was fucked up. I was like, God damn. I was like, why?
Yeah, I was like,
I would have much preferred the racist thing over this.
I was like, it got way dark in that one.
So, you know, Hank's like, show me. And his little brother's like, but I wanted to see the room and this and that. And Hank's like, obviously needs to protect his little brother from basically getting sexually abused.
Which is horrible, but at the same time,
he wasn't going to let that happen.
What he was supposed to do.
Right.
Which is a big theme.
It's okay, bro.
It's a big theme of,
it's fucked up. It's fucked up. No,
that show.
It's not real because it's a show, but that shit happens in real life.
Yeah.
You know, and he's protecting his little brother.
And I
and he's like,
at first I didn't like the Hank character. I truly love the character of that. Just because he's a brash dick, you know what I mean? Yeah. He's like your Jocko type or whatever.
But not with Dawn. He's very sensitive.
Let's take a minute, guys. Yeah. I'll be right back.
I'm in this episode now, so.
And we're back, as Joe says on the Now Watch This podcast. You guys, go listen to that. They just did Not Another Teen Movie. So we just got through talking about, I wiped my eyes already, about the Hawk story of
Hawk
seeing
and
his
Dove
little bro.
Story, right?
The original Dove, because his brother was
right,
Dove
the original
first.
Dove, so.
And
yeah, it's a shitty beginning of the story, but
yeah,
it leads to what's happening, and then you really.
So does Hawk kind of go on a downward? No, he goes up. He becomes a football star.
Right. So he becomes a football star, mm-hmm. but he's also like, you know, he's a jock, gets in trouble. His brother's the good nerdy kid.
Outfit,
yeah, you
yeah.
know, and he gets hit pretty bad in one of the games. They win the championship for the
yeah,
season.
Yeah, he gets like a concussion.
And his brother's watching at home on TV.
And
he's
rocking
worried.
A Superman shirt.
Right. And
yeah,
he's worried.
Cool.
He goes to see him at the school. And he's like, yeah, man, like, are you sure you should be drinking? Are you okay? Because they're partying. They just won the championship for their school.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, no, I'm fine. You sound like mom or whatever. Well, then he fucking passes out.
Yeah.
Well, because he probably has a concussion. Because he got pretty hot. Hit pretty hard.
His brother takes him to the doctor, right? He's in the hospital.
And he's like, are you going to go see the doctor? And he's like, yes. You know, Hank, which is Hawk,
mm-hmm.
tells his brother, yes, I'm going to go. I have an appointment tomorrow. So he goes with him to the doctor. And the doctor's like, you know, you need to take a break. You're fucked up. Like, you need to heal. And he's like, when the season's over, I will.
Yeah. And he's kind of pissed at him, right?
Right.
He's pissed at his
yeah.
little brother for like, being like, man,
he's
what the fuck,
his
man?
Little brother
you're trying
because...
to like make me like not play and...
Yeah, you know.
Oh,
because
he also tells the coaches, doesn't he?
Right. So then it skips over to his little brother's in the library, you know, doing homework or whatever, doing schoolwork. And Hank comes in and he's like, what the fuck you told, you know, the fucking coach or whatever that, you know, whatever the doctor said. And he's like, dude, I'm just trying to protect you. And they're arguing in the library and some dude comes behind Hawk and he's like, hey, you know, this is a library, dick, or whatever. And he just fucking wails on him, you know? And his little brother is like, oh, shit. Like, they saw the two brothers, which is Hawk and his other brother. I can't remember his name.
I can't remember his name either.
Hank, which is Hawk, and his brother, they start fighting all
Emmett,
these
Emmett.
All these dudes. No. Uh-huh. That's
Randall. Steve?
Emmett is from vampire movie. I can't even think of the name.
The Lego movie.
Okay, no, you're just guessing.
Twilight
now.
Movie. Emmett is in the Lego movie.
Emmett
too,
is. No, Emmett's in the Lego movie. Yeah. This fucking guy. Come get him, guys.
Anyway.
So they just start kicking ass. Hank and his brother start kicking ass in the library because all these dudes are trying to fucking get him, you know? Uh-huh. And they're kicking ass. So then they're in the office and, you know, the fucking dean's like, what the fuck? Like, I could understand Hank fighting, but you?
They're like this. Like...
Pretty much. And, you know, they're trying to say that they're sorry. And the dean's like, well, I didn't hear that from Hank, which is like, you know, the fucking jock muscle head or whatever. And then the little brother's like, hey, man, what the fuck? Like, my brother's giving so much to this school and this and that. And like, why don't you just fucking expel us already? Because they don't really say it. But like in some parts of the of that episode, like it's you gather that information that they're like, they're not rich kids.
No.
They're from two different dads.
Right.
Their mom is, you know, working fucking probably two jobs, can't take care of her kids because she's got to work.
They're kind of riding on, like, Hank's athletic ability.
Right. And, well, the brother's probably smart, too. So yeah. They're there at that fucking nice college or whatever, but everybody's like, oh, y'all are outcasts because you're fucking not rich, fucking privileged folks.
Right, right.
So, you know, his brother's like, just fucking expel us already. Like, that's what you want to do. So they get expelled. They get kicked out of school.
Yeah.
And... you know, Hank's like, fuck, man, like, we got expelled. What are we going to do? Whatever. And the brother's like, you know, I understand what you're going through and why you are the way that you are. And he basically tells Hank that he knows what he did for him when they were kids. That
he figured it out.
Allowed himself to get molested by the coach so that he would protect his brother from that happening to him. Yeah. And Hank's like, you know, nothing happened. What are you talking about? Or whatever. So...
Joe's comments, guys, up there on the screen there where he says, Joseph Lucky Gastelum, copyright, and we're back. And then Lego Movie hits in some spots, no doubt.
Lego Movie does. I agree.
For sure. For sure.
But, and you know, him and Hank are talking, and he's like, what are we going to do? And, you know, his brother basically like confronts him about what happened when they were younger. He tells him, I have an idea. And that's when they become. Hawk and Dove. So Hawk is Hank and Dove is his younger brother. They become vigilantes together.
That's like their way of like, we can still be doing something. We have these demons in us and like
we can be doing something good for our neighborhood.
Right.
That
right.
No one else is doing.
And they're filming it too though. They're putting
they're filming
it on,
it
like,
too, yes.
On YouTube or whatever in the middle of the time.
They barely become Hawk and Dove. They get in the newspaper. They're at the newspaper stand, and they're like, oh, my God, so excited or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then Dawn and her mom are leaving.
Brunch?
Dawn is actually a ballerina.
Oh, okay.
Dawn is a ballerina, and it clips over to, like, Dawn. So Dawn becomes a later Dove. She is performing. She's a ballerina, and her mom is there. She's so proud. They go have tea afterwards, and they're walking on the sidewalk, and they bump into Hank and his brother.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, oh, my God, so sorry, whatever, blah, blah. They're saying sorry, whatever. And in the midst of that apologetic bumping, some fucking car is speeding and hits another car, and that car... It gets hit and it spins and it hits and it kills Don's mom and Hank's brother at the same time, right in front of them.
Which is like I was like so random. I was like, what the fuck?
It was so random. I was not expecting that.
Yeah, like I would like to do more research on that, like to see like if that is any part of the story, because I was like, I felt like sometimes I feel like some deaths should be more meaningful or whatever, you know what I mean? Like maybe like I don't know. So these are some of the little parts of Titans that I would have personally tightened up if I was on the Now Watch This podcast. I would say this would be in the part where things that you could change. If I can change, you can change. On this part, I would say what I would change is I would have just tightened it up. Like I would have had, yes, Dawn has lost, maybe it's the loss of her mother. Yes, Hank has lost, maybe it's the loss of his brother, but I would have just like in another way, like maybe,
like not so dramatic?
No. Equally dramatic, if not more so. Like I would have had maybe Hawk and Dove, his brother Dove, are doing the crime fighting thing or whatever. But then like they realize it's getting too risky and they want to get out of it or whatever, well, then maybe some guys catch up with them because they're new at it or whatever, and they follow them back to their apartment. They fucking execute the brother in front of him or something like that. Then it would have been like, you know what I mean? Like, maybe his last words like, don't ever quit, Hank. Don't ever quit. Make them all pay or whatever, something like that. And then they're like, blow his fucking
brain out. Are you trying to make motherfuckers cry?
Cut his throat or something like that. Then he's like, I will never quit this quest until I fucking get these motherfuckers. And the same thing with Dawn or whatever. Like, maybe they fucking like,
I mean, I could see, where you're coming from.
Because it seems so random. Like, I didn't expect that. Like, I was like, I felt like I was like, oh, were they trying to tighten up the story?
Well, I think
story?
That's
like,
what makes like, it. Well, yeah.
Truck out of nowhere.
I think that makes it more like, yeah, you're not expecting that.
Yeah. But now I did like how, in my way, you wouldn't have that, them taking a break. They would just continue to be. But in the way they did it, it was kind of neat where they end up at the...
At the
coping,
grief,
the grief counseling and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know? I thought that was a cool aspect too, because I was like, well, how did they meet, you know? And, you know, their relatives both died at the same time and the same day right in front of us.
Yeah.
And they meet there and they're...
Yeah, which was like total, like, you know, that's like total wonton chaos.
And I was actually surprised that, like, Hank would be at one of those things.
Yeah.
Because of the type of person that he is, like a hothead, like, I'm not showing my emotions, right. I'm not going to spill my heart, but...
Don't really bond until they're at the bar.
Right, but I think a big part of Hank, I think he's, like, one of, like you said, like, I didn't really care for him in the beginning because he was, like, fucking meathead or whatever.
Yeah.
And I get that, but at the same time, you can see where he is, like, a sensitive person or whatever, like, especially
sure.
when he's with Dawn. Like, sure. she is his... They balance each other.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, and, I mean, it does help to me, like, his story, like, that
oh, yeah.
personal sacrifice mm-hmm. is, like, in that locker room scene, like, Hank gives up a part of his soul.
Pretty much.
And stays in that locker room forever, and he doesn't ever
I'm not gonna cry.
Yeah, he doesn't get that back. Yeah. So that's the part that probably makes him a kind of a douchebag or whatever, but when you know why, it's like, in fact, because of that, I might have led with that, but it is kind of neat that it comes in the back end. So, like I said, there's a lot of things that the show, it's not perfect, guys. It's not, you know, Game of Thrones.
I mean, what show is?
It's not, you know what I mean? Yeah. I don't know. The Marvel shows are really
I sometimes fiery. Think shows are purposely made to make people fight about them.
Like, Game of Thrones, like, The Mandalorian, like,
so
The Mandalorian is pretty perfect, but there are moments, you know what I mean?
Mandalorian is good.
Mandalorian is pretty perfect. I can't really think of anything bad. But, so... That one, but people have a lot of things to say about, like, you know, like, well, we've done them all, me and Double A, like, Loki, Falcon and Winter Soldier, you know what I mean, like, WandaVision or whatever.
I'm still doing Falcon and Winter Soldier. I haven't finished.
Yeah, like,
but I did Loki.
This one probably does fall below all those in a lot of ways, but then in a lot of ways, it really hits. It really, really does. And so it really gets stuff right, so.
Yeah, that episode was one of my favorite ones. I know we're not done talking about it, but,
yeah.
you know, they, are at that grief counseling together mm-hmm. and
mm-hmm. no, I mean, I know that, like, we had
he goes to a bar,
yeah.
Dawn shows up, tries to talk to him, and then he's like being an asshole. Like,
yeah, he kind of blows her off, which I also thought too was kind of unrealistic because I'm like, man, she's absolutely gorgeous. This is like,
yeah, no, but when you're grieving the way he was, I don't think that's the first thing
I'm
on
like,
your mind.
What, whatever, man. I'm like, no better way to grieve than with like a fucking super hot, like. That chick is like a 10 or whatever.
No, because you know all he had left was his brother.
Yeah.
That's like if I died and you had no one else.
I did like that, like,
in you that, better be grieving.
Yeah, I did like in that scene that, like, he made her sleep on the couch or whatever. Like, that was kind of funny or whatever.
Yeah,
like,
it was.
Like, okay, like, it that's kind of cool. Like, he really just wanted to
and
talk
I really
her.
Loved, like, you know, they become friends and they get close together and they're bonding because, you know, his brother died and her mom died in the same exact moment. In front of both of them.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're getting to know each other.
Which is its own bond in its way.
I really love that they're both doing, I really love that they're both doing things that, like, their mom loved. Like,
yeah.
Dawn's mom and the brother loved, you know?
Yeah.
The pizza place and the tea
pizza,
in the afternoon.
Tea. Yeah, I forgot about that.
That was, I really
loved
that
episode that really
part.
Stuck with you. That episode, really it that resonated with me, but it didn't. But I love the way that, what did we say her name was? Mina? Mira? Oh, shoot. Mira?
Dawn?
Minka Kelly? Yeah.
No,
we'll
call her Dawn.
Dawn.
She's Dove.
Dove. I love the way that the actress plays it. Like, she does such a wonderful job. Her voice, I love her voice.
It's soothing.
It's very soothing, yeah. Minka.
She's
Minka.
Gentile.
Minka Kelly. Yeah. Her, she's just, you know, the way she talks, whatever. Like, and there's never like a lot of like, there's a lot of like heavy handed things that could have happened. Like, there's things I could have seen. Like, when he put her on the couch, I thought she was going to like maybe throw her stuff at him and like go in the bed or something like that. But I'm glad she didn't. Like, I'm like, oh, okay. Like, the character kept a lot of integrity.
Yeah, like you expect certain things sometimes. And then when it doesn't happen, you're like, I like that. I like that it wasn't what I expected.
Yeah. Joe says, I did Loki.
I wish I would have did him, Joe.
He's bisexual, according to the Marvel Universe. Now,
hey, he gets the best of both worlds. I'm not judging.
So, yeah.
I do. Joe's three shots in.
I do. Yeah. Wrap that one up because we got to try a new one. We're bringing back the old tradition of trying new beers. And Double A just likes the Dos Equis now, so we're going to do the new beer because the other one, then we're drinking it, we're not enjoying it.
He's a creature of habit. Kind of like you, bro.
Creature of habit, yeah. But, okay. Anything else on that particular episode so we can move on to a little bit of season two?
No, I think that was my favorite, one of my favorite episodes, yeah. I think, of this season, yeah.
And we're kind of all over the place, right? Because we really skipped over, like, a lot of, like, the Rachel story. So if you're, like, a fan of Raven, and I became a fan of Raven in this show.
I love them all.
I know, you love
Grayson, but Grayson's not my favorite character.
No, yeah. Dick Grayson's definitely my favorite. You know, yeah. But there is a lot going on that we've yet to touch on because we got wrapped up in this jerkwad. You know what I mean? But again, in this universe, jerkwad. And I like Mr. Ian Glenn as Bruce Wayne or whatever, but we don't get to that till season two. So let's move forward into some season two stuff. You're not done.
I'm not done. So only got all the way up to maybe episode 6.
Okay. Maybe. Okay. Let me check. I'm just going to check how many episodes there are, but
because if you look at the titles and the
they don't match up.
If you look at the titles and the stills, you'll know like what we can talk about, what we can't.
Okay. Tell me what
So in season two,
what started you off? Where did you go? What did you like?
I'm trying to think. So Corey's trying to figure out who she is.
Oh, yeah. Well, number one, let's back up a little bit, guys. So the reason why Dick was having that crazy vision that we told you about at the end of season one, and then...
Because
Rachel is dad is...
Which is Trigon.
Trigon, this demon, is coming back.
Right.
And so, he's fucking with all her friends, and he's got them all fucked up.
Yeah, like, we missed a hole. So, like, Rachel's being hunted, basically.
But it's good, though, because this gives you guys reason to go watch it, and you're going to get so much more story than what we're giving you.
Rachel's being hunted. She doesn't know why after her mother gets killed. She ends up, like, hooking up with, you know, and I don't mean hooking up in that sense, but, you know, with Corey and then Gar. And they're kind of running together now. And then eventually, like Grayson, too. And, you know, Corey doesn't know who she is, trying to figure it out. But for some reason, she knows that she's looking for Rachel. Well, she finds her and, you know... basically kind of saves her from some of the other people that are looking for her. Right. So I'm episode 6.
Okay.
I already finished episode 6.
Okay. Okay.
Of season 2. So I'm halfway. But I believe
that helps me.
How many episodes is there? 12. I think season 2 has.
I'll show you this thumbnail.
12?
13.
Okay, so I'm pretty much halfway through season 2. I'll finish, and then maybe Double A and CM will let me be on another episode so we finish it.
Yeah.
But
I need to start doing, like, some side episodes.
Yeah.
Bonus episodes.
I would love to be in those. I would be honored to do those. You know,
bonus episodes would be cool, whatever. But okay, so now I know where you're at, so I can help myself know.
Yeah, so... you know, Corey's trying to figure out who she is. She doesn't know fucking anything, and she's finding little clues here and there. And
now we're back in season one, right? You're back.
Right. This is like the last episode.
Or no, we're at the beginning of season one. Season two. Maybe. I don't know where we are, but what? Mm-hmm. Tell the story. What's happening?
So, you know, Corey's she's been trying to figure out who she is, and she does figure out that she needs to find Rachel. She mm-hmm. doesn't know who she is or where she needs to find her, but she does. I forget. What clue? I know she has a key. She has a key to a locker in a skating rink.
Excuse me. She traces her path back to that, and then that leads her to this room where it's like her stuff, and she can figure out that.
Right. So then she goes to the locker in the skating rink because she gets a clue from someone. And there's another key in there. And she's like, what the fuck? Like, another key. I've been holding on to this key forever.
Right.
You know, so she's tracking herself down as the show goes along. And, you know, she's running with Rachel and Gar, mm-hmm. you know, and Rachel finds out from these guys that are hunting her that the woman that got killed that she thought was her mom is not her real mom.
Yeah.
And he tells her, your real mom is in this fucking psychiatric ward of some mm-hmm. sort. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she's alive and well, you know, go find her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they don't know whether to believe him or not because he's been fucking hunting her.
Yeah.
They go. And
they do a lot of like questionable stuff where I'm like, right. Why didn't you do that?
Because you don't know. It's already like, and she's already like, already had episodes with her powers and stuff. And
yeah.
There's a lot of going on.
A lot of people do like one off things too, like to like kind of progress the story where I'm like, why would you not take someone with you or tell one of the other super fucking heroes that you know?
Yeah, like, you know, and
what
and
the fuck?
Grayson's like, wait, let's figure out a plan. You know, we're not going to go yet to save your mom. But of course, Rachel and is like, what the, I want to go now, like right now. And yeah. He's like, no, let's do it the right way. Let's do some recon. Let's figure it out. But Rachel's like, okay, whatever. So she basically recruits Gar and she's like, come with me, you know, let's go. Yeah. And at first he's like, no, but then he's like, let's do this. Like, I'm going to help you because
yeah.
he's taken a liking to her, you
right,
know, and he wants
right.
to help her. They go to this fucking place where they have her mom locked up. They break in, they get busted.
Yeah. And let's back up a little bit. Cause anyone that knows, if you do enter into one of this show and you have a little bit of knowledge, you know that certain characters have a relationship already kind of built in, like,
right.
you know, through the previous stuff that's been out or whatever. So obviously Beast Boy and Rachel, or Gar and Rachel, Beast Boy and Raven, they have like a thing for each other or whatever. So there's that. And we also know that Starfire.
Well, Beast Boy has a thing for Raven.
Yeah. I think it fleshes out eventually, I think.
Yeah.
And Starfire,
well, I'm going by the cartoon.
Yeah. Starfire and Starfire and Robin have a thing or whatever.
Robin's all about Starfire and she's just like, whatever.
I think it's, yeah.
It's like the girls are like, whatever.
But in the cartoon and maybe even in the comic books, Joe, if you're out there still, correct me if I'm wrong, but is it like, is Starfire with the Tim Drake version or which version does she have a relationship with? Because in this show, it's Starfire and
is with Dick Grayson.
Dick Grayson.
Yeah.
And they're not with each other, but they definitely do hook up. Like, they have that
in the show, right?
In the show, yeah.
Which I thought, I didn't think he was going to go for it because he's all like, I don't need nobody.
Well, you know what was really cool about the movie that Joe had me watch? It's just called Batman and Harley Quinn. And again, it's just like a standalone movie. Like, there's no, like, episodes where it's just...
It's
like, animated.
Oh, it's animated.
Yeah, HBO MAX or whatever. I was like, Nightwing hook up with Harley.
Batman? Well,
no, Nightwing.
I mean, Harley is hot.
Dick Grayson. Yeah, I was like, all right. Like, I was like, they wrote this in.
Wearing them sexy ass outfits and shit.
I was like, this took a little bit of a turn that I really dug or whatever. So that's a pretty cool part. Now.
It's just like the chicks like the bad boys, the dudes like the bad girls.
There you go.
You just got to get in there sometimes.
So, bring us back. So.
So. Gar and Rachel.
Oh, hold on. We're trying this new one.
Oh,
what
yeah,
is
we're
it?
Doing,
show it up there. So
we're doing. I can't even pronounce it.
It's Tucker.
Can we get it?
Fest Bia.
It's too bright. How do you
hold on.
Turn it down a notch. There you go. I think it says
Fest
Bia. I can't even say it right.
Fest Bia. We're in the dark.
We're in the money.
Joe says, I'm only wearing a Batman shirt because it's cool. He says, he's wearing a Spider-Man shirt. he also says, since I always ask what he's wearing, that's very true. Look at these weird lighting options here if you're watching us on.
Gotta get my double chin right.
On the live there, you see that? Joe also says, go ahead.
Since Chuck always asks what I'm wearing, you said that one. Not sure what that's about, but you know these podcasters are weird.
Weird.
Hey, stay weird, podcasters.
Mm-hmm.
And then Joe also says, Harley, don't get that Dick Grayson that is.
There's the shots talking again.
Do, 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 do.
So, fast forward it though. It's just like, okay, we get it. There's a whole other side story. We don't need to tell the whole.
Oh yeah, so you know, they
watch the show to see the whole Corey and Rachel and all that. But basically, her demon dad reemerges or whatever.
Right? Do you just say reemerges or?
Well, what do you say?
Well, I mean, you know.
Well, that's because we already talked about how Dick Grayson was like kind of like having this, was possessed and having this vision or whatever.
Right. You know, but there's a certain way that the dad can only come back. You know.
Right.
And
right.
You know, so he's back. And basically, one of his powers, because I'm sure he has several, is that he brings out the bad in you, I guess.
Okay.
Your, what, all the things that you've thought about that were bad that you didn't do.
That you would want to do.
He makes you relive those in your mind.
Right.
So you are under his control, under our mind control, and you're thinking of these things that you thought of. But you're actually doing them,
mm-hmm.
You know, and that's when we talked about Grayson basically letting Batman die and going in after him.
Mm-hmm.
That was his
essentially like turning on him, and you know, if you want to call it that, and
right,
and pretty much hurting Batman back the way that he felt Batman had hurt him all this time. So, right. So I definitely get that.
Yeah. So, but he's not only in Grayson's mind, you know, because the other Titans like Dove and Hawk, and then Corey and
Gar.
No, well, Robin, they go, well, Robin 1 and Robin 2, Robin 2.0, like they say in the show. Like
Jason or
yeah, Dick and Jason, they figure out what's going on, and they go to save Rachel, and when they get there, they can't get in or whatever.
Yeah.
So then they get in, and Trigon, which is Rachel's dad, basically takes over their minds one by one, mm-hmm. by allowing them to relive the bad in them, like to live the bad that they wouldn't, that they didn't do, but that they have thought about.
Right.
You know, because we've all thought about
cheers
doing bad things but didn't act on them.
Mm-hmm.
Cheers.
Well, that's pretty easy.
Yeah, easier than the last.
For real. Okay.
But yeah. So everybody's mind is corrupted, and they, it's so cool. Like, you guys just got to watch it. Joe probably watched. I don't know. Joe watched it, right? I'm sure.
No, he said he hasn't.
Oh, okay.
He said he had the DC app, but then he said that he had season one ready to load up to watch, but he didn't get to watch it.
Oh, okay, well.
But it's on HBO Max. And I know Joe has HBO Max.
So, yeah, I mean.
But we're trying to talk a little bit about season two. Like, let's just try to hit on some of the high points, and then we can maybe wrap it up or whatever.
Okay.
Because we're going to finish this block.
So basically, in season two, Rachel defeats her dad.
Trigon, right? Which, what did you think about how he looked when they showed him?
I thought he looked awesome. I thought it was going to look fucking whack.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought
so too. When they show his hand and the crystal, I was like, oh, that looks good.
Yeah, that's neat. It looked cool.
When he's becoming,
mm-hmm.
and then you see, and then he gets the horn.
I didn't like when I first, because I knew nothing about this character. So all this for me is like, okay, fresh.
It makes me want to watch some of the Teen Titan Go episodes, because they show him. He's a demon.
Okay.
But I don't remember what it looks like.
Okay.
I got to like watch it.
Well, in that one I'm watching right now that Joe has me watching, which is the Teen Titans versus Justice League, whatever, animated movie. He already appears. He's like the primary villain.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, so it's pretty cool. Like, it's kind of like playing with the her history story or whatever.
Right.
And in this one, it's the Titans are, Starfire, Beast Boy, Blue Beetle, the Latino one I mentioned or whatever.
Raven.
And then they bring, Batman's had it up to here with Damian, Robin, his son, Robin. Damian Wayne. And Nightwing transports them over or whatever. So it's cool you get some of that. Oh, and yeah, Raven's there or whatever. So it's pretty cool or whatever. And then
they start talking about
the Trigon. Yeah, I like her too. In fact, when she came out of Fortnite, I was using her character a lot.
Yeah.
But anyway, so yeah, they defeat Trigon, which was cool. Like, I thought that
kind of got
cool.
A Hellboy feeling from him a little bit.
Yeah, I picked up those vibes.
Yeah.
And it made me wonder, because I'm always kind of thinking this show, like, okay, once the squad gets through this threat, what will be the next threat or whatever? So. You kind of have the typical, like, the team's going to break up thing. But we also meet a new character in season two, right? Which is Donna Troy.
Right.
Who did you figure? You asked me, who is this?
Right. I figured out that I know she's from the Mascara.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know who she is to Diana. I don't know if she's okay. like a kid or a cousin or
not just, a kid. I think she's just more like a
an Amazon.
Yeah, an Amazon. Okay. From what I know.
Well, like, I know she was born there.
Yeah.
But yeah.
From I what know. I gather, she's like the would be like the next Wonder Woman. Like,
mm-hmm.
She's Wonder Girl or whatever. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, because she has the lasso.
I don't think she has the lasso. I think it's
well, a she lasso. Has a lasso, but yeah. I've always just known Wonder Woman to have that.
Yeah.
So I was kind of like,
I'm not familiar with
that. I don't know character. If I really like that about, yeah. you know, because I'm like, that's Wonder Woman's thing.
Right. I don't know that I'm familiar with if that character has it also, whatever, but.
Yeah, because she's Wonder Girl, right?
Wonder Girl. Right.
See, I don't know Wonder Girl.
Yeah. I knew there was a Wonder Girl, but I wasn't familiar with the whole story is or whatever.
Right.
Joe says, bro, I'm on it tonight. I gotta let these save these jokes for not watch this pod.com. And he also says Trigon Rocks in Justice League Dark 2. Okay, so there's two Justice League Darks.
Okay.
I hear a lot of good reviews about that Justice League Dark. They said that's
okay. Says that's a good see, one. There's like I already did so many shows I need to watch, yeah.
But see, that's a good thing. These are like movies. They're like it's like an hour, like the Killing Joke you watched.
Oh, okay.
Like,
well,
it's like
that's
an hour 20 movie. So it's not like a long movie, like a 2-hour movie. It's just like a quick, but it's cool because I think a lot of those DC ones come right out of the comics. So
yeah.
But anyway, so Trigon is defeated. We kind of have our new team, which is going to be like who. Dick Grayson,
Gar. Raven, which is Rachel, Gar, right. which is Beast Boy, and, well, you think,
Donna?
Well, no, Starfire.
Oh, Starfire, that's right, yeah. Because Hawk and Dove say they're going to go do their, like, they're going
to
get out of
the game. Yeah, because they're trying to get out of the game.
Yeah, they're trying to get out
of the game. They were just there to help or whatever, because Rachel had reached out.
Yeah, they were like playing their part or whatever.
And then Donna was obviously there too to just help out. So
and we get her cool story where it's like, oh, Donna is like, you know, again, Wonder Girl, and her and Dick have a past. They showed them like as kids, right? Like,
yeah. Well, I mean, she's older, but they were in the Titans together.
Yeah. So that's pretty. And then you know we kind of know that there was like a previous version of the Titans, but we don't know what's up with them.
Right, which would be Hawk and Dove, and then Robin and Wonder Girl.
And. Aqualad, yeah.
Which I thought was
from Atlantis. Corny. Yeah, that's the actual name from the comics. I knew that.
Okay,
because everybody had like kind of like a sidekick.
Or I would have done Aqua Boy or Aqua Kid or.
Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back, guys. Last block, guys. The last 30 we're gonna do right here. So on Titans, and it's okay because Amy only got through half of a season on season 2.
Right.
And there's a whole other 6 episodes.
3 hours for half a season.
But yeah. But she said we're going to do a short one. Not 3 hours tonight, bro.
This was different. This was different, guys.
So easy to do a short one. She keeps reading the comments, and she's like the Kevin Smith of this show. So I got to turn them off for her. But, okay, so where are we at? Trigon is defeated. We got the new team set up. We get into the history of Aqualad. We see that Donna's got something there with that story.
She's struggling with it.
Yeah.
She's struggling with the Aqualad and being there at the Titan Tower and the mascara, which is where she's from.
Yeah. She's got the whole loner vibe too thing going.
Right. She doesn't want to get involved and she doesn't want to give herself. And it's a whole fucking thing.
Okay.
And I'm just like, go girl, it's fine.
Okay. So let's move forward. Okay, so we can get to as far as you've gotten. So,
so then there's tragedy, and she decides to stay.
Mm-hmm.
Donna, which is Wonder Girl, she stays, and they want to get revenge on the person that caused the tragedy. Mm-hmm. And
who is this character?
It's going to be Deadshot?
Deathstroke. Yeah.
Deathstroke.
So big reveal that Deathstroke, which is, I believe, a primary villain also, you know, we get him related with Batman.
Which, but I'm not really impressed with his character.
Now, you know who the actor is, right? Isai Morales plays Deathstroke, and I loved his performance.
What does he come on? I can't
see. Richie! That's Bob.
It should have been Bob.
Bob is Destro.
Bob the Builder, y'all.
So Bob's mom.
No, I didn't know that until now, but now that I can see him, he's much older, obviously. I think
he does a fantastic
job. I'm not saying that he does a... I wasn't in love with his character. Like, he caused this tragedy that caused the Titans.
Amy never likes the bad guys. If the bad guys do bad things, she's like,
oh, I love the Joker. I said that.
What about when he kills people and kids? You like that?
I mean, he's fucking sick. He can't...
Anywho. I think the costume looked great. They did a great job.
The costume did look great.
I think Issa Morales looked good. I mean, like, you know, from what I've seen of two Deathstrokes, this one and Joe Manganiello, who comes out quickly in... Justice League, and even quicker in the Snyder Cut of Justice League.
Which I still need to watch.
This one was very cool. It looked cool. It looked legit. And I do believe that the Titans and Deathstroke have a history, because I believe like the first appearance of... It's either the Titans or Nightwing and the Nightwing costume. It's okay. Like Deathstroke's on the cover or whatever. You can look that up in the comic book world. So it's cool that they incorporate him and have these worlds cross over. But yeah, I think Issa Morales does a great job. I didn't recognize him at first either. His voice is very different. It's not the Bob voice from La Bamba.
He's much older.
Yeah, he's much older.
Was he fucking in his teens when he did that movie?
But he looked pretty good. He looked pretty good.
Yeah, suit. He looked pretty good, kind of buff, kind of jacked a little bit.
It's probably the suit, but it looks
good. But, you know, so the Titans, they want revenge.
Sure.
You know?
Which is probably wrong to get revenge.
Right, they want revenge because...
Or at least to catch him, you know what I mean?
Sure. But they don't know how to get to him. Mm-hmm. They get to him through his child.
Yeah.
Which I wasn't sure exactly what happened yet, because they haven't really revealed exactly what happened yet. But I can kind of guess.
Yeah.
You know, they use his kid to get to him, which obviously is definitely the wrong thing to do in any situation. Mm-hmm. You don't use a fucking innocent. And when you get... Before they show the scene where they find the son to get to Deathstroke...
Mm-hmm. Whose name is Jericho? The son's name is Jericho.
Jericho, you get the idea that the mom is protecting him from someone.
Right.
You know, because he has the window open in their apartment and she's like, what's our first thing? And, you know, you got to protect yourself and, like, you know, safety first and cautions and all this stuff. So you get the idea that they're already hiding from the dad.
Right.
Which is Deathstroke.
Yeah.
You know, or they fear him or something. So, you know, to use the kid to get to him is just wrong on every level. And I don't tell you what happens, but I can guess. I'm not stupid. Something bad.
Not their best strategy. And you would think that a superhero team would maybe think better of it. But again, they're not sidekicks. I think they do better than that. They make them cool. They make them everything. And they're in San Francisco, so it's like they're in their own city. They're not in Gotham or Metropolis, whatever. I mean, but they're just like,
I think initially they start off as sidekicks, but they become more than
they
that.
Don't have, yeah, they just didn't, it was
they become
just,
their own persons, yeah. and they become their own team, and they're something bigger than just sidekicks.
Yeah, and it wasn't a great plan or whatever with the kid or whatever. But
it really wasn't, but yeah. At that point, okay. You're...
And you haven't seen how that story plays out yet.
Right, I haven't
seen how you're not there yet. Okay, so that's probably almost as far as Amy got, except for one more episode, which introduces yet another new character. Very popular character in the DC world, I believe, especially in this kind of younger group.
They don't really reveal what his name would be yet, but I'm guessing Superboy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Superboy. His name's Connor in the show. Mm-hmm. But I had already had questions as soon as they showed his clip. I was like, what's going on? What's happening here?
Yeah.
But basically...
I love the shirt. It's just
he's a clone.
Black shirt with the red
S. So that part's funny because he tries to take the shirt off a street stand in where... They're in San Francisco, right?
I think he's in Metropolis at the time he breaks out or whatever. I think.
Okay, maybe. Maybe.
But yeah, guys, if you know, like, the comic books, whatever, this goes way back, sis, because this is back when Superman died in the comic books, issue 75 of Superman, whatever, Doomsday killed him, with air quotes. And after that, the next big thing that the comic books did was they released for Superman, and it was like, who was the real one? There was, like, the one that was, like, half robot, half Superman, which was, like, I think they called him the cyborg Superman. Then there was one that was, like, He had this weird suit and like these yellow glasses. That was the Eradicator. Then there was Superboy, which was a young Superman that had like a leather jacket, like kind of like a high fade. Mm. And then there was Steel. And it was neat because they called him each one. One was like the all steel suit Superman, which was like the Man of Steel. Then the young kid one was the Metropolis Kid. Then the Eradicator was, I believe, the last son of Krypton. And then the Cyborg one was the Man of Tomorrow, like a cyborg.
Right.
These are all nicknames that regular Superman has, manager. So it was kind of neat that they made, out of the four nicknames, they brought an individual Superman out of that. So Superman came out of that. Those Supermen came out of that or whatever. And then they each got their own little stories or whatever.
Okay.
But the story of the one that was the Metropolis Kid, Superboy, he was like the young looking one of them, was that he was half the DNA of Clark Kent or Superman and half the DNA of Lex Luthor. He built him in a lab.
Right.
And so that story apparently continued because I talked to Albert about this as a DC fan. And I was like, so the Superboy now is the Superboy from way back in like the 90s when that happened? He's like, yeah. He's like, that's still Connor Kent or whatever. Okay. He's like, you know, so I was like, they incorporated that into this show or whatever. So you get
which
a Superboy there.
I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it yet. I need to get, I only watched the one episode.
Yeah. And you get Crypto, the dog, too.
Which is my favorite. I was like, dude.
Best ever.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, But I'm not sure yet how I feel about the Connor character. Obviously, like they said in the show, he's barely learning. He's
yeah. I think they said he has like the mind of like a 4-year-old or something. Like, I think very young.
I think he said of a 2-year-old.
Oh, wow. I get a little bit more than that because, so, you know, he can speak.
And well, I think he's developing. He's a fast learner. Like, he can grasp things faster than a normal human being, you know? But I was like, I think I asked you, I was like, I don't even know how they got Superman's DNA. How Lex Luthor got Superman's DNA.
Yeah.
You know, because, yeah. I mean, I hate Lex Luthor. He sucks. But that's just me.
There you go. There you go.
He's like, I didn't like him as a villain. I was like, you're trash. I don't know a lot about him. I just don't like him.
I mean, Lex is...
He sucks as a bad guy.
He's up there. He's up there with the in the, for lack of a better term, lexicon of DC villains. He is among the elite or whatever, you know what I mean? So,
But that is as far as I got, which is episode 6 of season 2 of The Titans. Mm-hmm. I plan to finish or catch up. I don't want to say finish because it's still running.
Yeah.
But I plan to catch up and then...
Well, it'd be cool when you catch up because we'll be like watching at the same time. So that'll be neat.
Yeah. Whatever. But, so
like, we'll be like, hey, let's watch an episode or whatever, the new ones.
Right.
When they come out every Thursday or whatever, guys. So, I mean, without saying, we already said already, but...
We didn't even touch, though.
I highly suggest it because I highly suggested it to my sis who I knew that likes superhero genre stuff, would like that. Again, the familiarity with the Titans and the Teen Titans Go helps. And, you know, you don't need that, but it still makes it more fun. I think that you kind of have a knowledge base for the characters. But you can just watch it cold or whatever. Like I said, Friday Night or Holty Bear, I think, watched it cold. And I think he said he's liking it. He's probably about as far as you.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying it. I like that. I think I've told CM before, I like when I get the backstories on the characters that are in a movie or in a show or whatever it may be. Especially when I get involved with the character.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, I need to know more.
Yeah. Joe says, how, Bob, how could you do this to Richie? To Richie? I did this to me. So.
Shame okay. it, Bob.
I know. So who is the character that you're invested in the most right now? So,
probably Corey, but okay. It's, I don't know. It's a tough tie between Corey and probably Rachel only because I really love the backstory on Rachel, like her dad's a demon and
yeah,
you know, she's trying to control her powers and she doesn't know if she's bad or good.
Yeah.
But I also love the fact that Corey, which is Starfire, she's not from here. And you find out in the movie that she's next in line to be queen in the show.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, see, I didn't know that, you know, and, you know, she has these cool powers and I feel like she probably has more power that she hasn't developed yet or knows about maybe, or I don't know. It's just those two are just really cool, I guess, because they're not of Earth, you know?
Yeah. So for me, it's definitely like, I love, you know, the Dick Grayson character. Again, like I said, to me, Nightwing is like a more perfect version of Batman. Mm-hmm. If there could be one or whatever, because I guess I would say he has more of a heart
right?
More of a soul.
And real quick on the Nightwing thing is that obviously he's not Robin anymore because we have
Jason Todd. And in fact, they haven't.
And they keep doing all these things like, well, who are you? Right. Well, who are you going to be?
Right.
And I'm like, just do it already.
Right. Right.
So I'm waiting for him to become Nightwing because I know it's coming. I just am waiting to see.
And again, I've been calling him Nightwing since before because the Dick Grayson one in the comic books, Dick Grayson has been Nightwing for a long time now.
Right.
Because that's where we had Jason Todd Robin. Then we had Tim Drake Robin or whatever. Right. I mean, and then now we have the Damian Wayne Robin or whatever. But at the same time, we've got
Knew about the other Robins. I just didn't know about the Damian. I didn't know that Wayne had a kid.
No. Yeah, that's kind of like fairly new, I think, but it's now been around like a while.
I'm like, Damian? That's like a devil.
Yeah, and he is a little asshole, in my opinion, whatever. I don't particularly care for the character.
So you were loving the
Dick Grayson character, Dick Grayson. Obviously. Right. I want to see him come into his own. It's hard for me not to like the Connor character because it's like a Superman or whatever,
right.
But I'm not super in love. I love
because I'm just getting to him, I
love Dove, but I don't know that if I feel like there's a lot there. I mean, like, I guess I kind of want to see her with Robin, you know what I mean? You know,
really,
with Dick Grayson in a way, yeah, in a ways, since kind of like I saw that episode, like his fantasy or whatever, you know. A part of me wonders if the actor that plays Bruce Wayne, you know, Ian Glenn, you know, Jorah, will ever wear the suit. Now that's in my mind, like, I'm like, will they ever show him? Like, even if they just showed him with the neck down, like with the cowl down, it would be like pretty neat, you know.
You know, and it's funny because I love him.
Mm-hmm.
And I love him from Game of Thrones.
Mm-hmm.
He's great, but he's a little bit older.
Yeah.
So to imagine him in the suit fighting, you're just like,
yeah.
Hey, kind of getting up there, Batman, kind of old.
For sure. Yeah.
Because in real life, he's probably what, in his 50s?
Maybe.
Early 60s, maybe?
It's something that they kind of play with in the comics a lot, though, which is cool. Like, if you ever read The Dark Knight Returns, like, it's all about, like, Batman being, like, this older Batman. Like, like a gray-haired Batman, like an old Batman. And in Kingdom Come, that's the same thing, too, whatever. Well, that's what I'm saying. That guy kind of, like, you know, I have to admit, when I'm watching him on screen as Bruce, and he looks sharp. They dress him up sharp. I'm imagining him, like, I'm looking at him from the mouth down. I'm like, does he have the mouth? Like,
When I first saw him, I thought it was Alfred.
That's what I thought too. I was wondering if I was the only one lost on that.
Because I was like, no, he's not gonna come outside.
Yeah, and I was like.
And then he said, you know, I watch everything with the captions on.
Yeah.
And it says Bruce talking, and I was like, oh my god.
Yeah, and see, I didn't know that because I went right into like several more episodes thinking that I was like, oh, look at Alfred looking all slick and shit. They got this dude to play Alfred from Game of Thrones, whatever. And then I was like,
because he could be a good Alfred.
Yeah, he would be a good Alfred.
But I really love him as Batman.
So you know they did a show called Pennyworth, right? That's supposed to be about Alfred's past.
Whatever. Right, I did.
I don't know if that's on whatever, but I had remembered that. I had always thought that would have been a cool story.
Yeah.
But I heard that the show didn't get a lot of, and I think I tried to watch like one and I couldn't get into it, and I was like, ah, this should be cool.
Whatever. I say when you watch a show for the first time, you got to give it at least two. You got to give it two.
I agree with you because for me, like with Spartacus, it took like six, and I was like, why am I still watching this? And then when I got to that sixth episode, though, I was like.
I started watching Lucifer. Whoever's watching right now, I started watching it, and it's kind of a tough watch. I got pretty far, but I was struggling, and I haven't finished because I'm just like, some episodes are really great, but some episodes I'm like,
and you know what? I've read that a lot, and I'm just like, man, how do people push through? Because I'm like, man, I just can't be watching like
the parts in that show of Lucifer, like when it's about God and Lucifer's mom and stuff. Those are cool parts, but other parts when he's being like. Detective sidekick.
That's just so stupid. I can't stand it. That's why I didn't get into it. And I, you know what? Somebody out there will do like a super cut of their own. Some fan will cut out all the detective shit and cut together all the good shit. And then I'll watch that. Somebody do that. Yeah, for real. I'll definitely watch that because I love shit like that. And I've heard so much good things about that guy. I think he's a good actor. Like, I mean, I've seen him.
He's
got a good look.
Even like his face as the devil, I'm like, y'all can be better.
And that's what I mean. Like with this show too, I'm sure people would be like, oh, I couldn't get through with it. Like whatever was hooky or whatever. And I'm like, no. I promise. It's not hard to push through.
Yeah. Like when it starts out with the action and everything, mm-hmm. like starts off, mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm more invested than when it starts off slow.
Like what I hate is that I watch so much stuff on my phone now and I'm like looking at it on like a little screen. And like,
you
it
know
looks
me,
dark.
I'm used to watching stuff on the little screen.
Yeah. I know you have it like right in your face though.
Because I'm like laying down or I'm fucking picking up Kello from
the show. Like, Mia Lotto's on my lunch and I have it on my stand and I'm like eating my lunch and I'm like watching it and I'm just like, damn, like, what the? I mean, like, there's no way I could read catch. Like, I dream of rewatching, like, on the big screen. I'm like, a lot of shit I'll watch twice. You know what I mean?
You have the power to do it.
Yeah, I know.
But, so definitely, you know, Dick Grayson for you. And you said, Connor, but you said you're
going to love him. But you know what? I'm really liking the Rachel character, too, and I'm following her. Like, I want to see more with her story or whatever, for sure.
I do love Gar, too. Like, my whole thing was that when he did the tiger thing, I was like, that's awesome. And I waited and waited and waited for him to be something else. And then when he did the snake, I was like, finally.
Yeah.
But I really, because, you know, in the Teen Titans Go, he can change into anything.
Anything
he wants. And I think he's still learning about his powers.
What's neat, this show. Again, what's neat, and I'm only in the first half of the movie, but that JLA versus Teen Titans, I'm watching whatever, like, he uses the powers really cool. So, like, he'll, like, turn into a bird, fly you up. Then he'll turn into, like, an elephant, like, smash down on you, like, all in one.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, shit, like, pretty badass.
Teen Titans Go, like, he can change, he changes into a bunch of different things, and it's really cool because he has that ability.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, but I also think that this show is kind of trying to play with, like, how are their powers developing?
Become.
Because the Rachel that we've seen, the Raven that we've seen, they didn't call her Raven yet?
No.
Yeah.
No. So when Corey and Dick Grayson find all of Corey's stuff in the storage.
Oh, they say that it's
they mention the Raven or whatever. Yeah. So like you get that, that's her name.
But she's not using the powers like in the cartoon where she's like doing force fields and like she can like push shit. Like even in the game they show her that her little emote in the Fortnite game is like she kind of like raises up these rocks and she kind of like forms them and she kind of like pushes them.
Yeah.
So it's neat or whatever, you know what I mean? And we
both know that she's still learning how to use those powers. And now her powers are different because her dad gave her that.
I would definitely say that she is, it's Grayson and her, my two, because she gives me a lot of like Wanda vibes from WandaVision. And I feel like I'm like, oh, there's a lot of power in her that we're not seeing. And I'm just like, how does that play out in the rest of the DC world? Because there's a lot of other big players and I don't really ever hear her name come up, but I'm like, she seems like she's very, very powerful.
Yeah.
And it's like either untapped or unknown or, they're not using it because if her powers come from like
the demonic, hell of Earth.
Yeah, no shit. Like, that's pretty badass.
But
cool. Is this what? Any other final thoughts?
No, I mean, I just would highly recommend it to whoever hasn't watched it, and I really love it. I haven't got all the way through. I'm gonna finish it, and hopefully we can watch the rest of the season 3 episodes together.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you're into that kind of thing, I recommend it. You know, the superhero thing.
I say give Titans a chance, guys. Yeah. Again, I'm not a particularly a DC guy. Even if it's
3 episodes. Do 3 episodes.
Yeah, do 3 episodes. Give yourself that much. I'm not particularly a DC guy. And again, if you're looking for like your bigs, you know what I mean? Like your Justice Leaguers are not there or whatever because it's the Titans, not them, whatever. But I think that...
But you kind of want to see them even if it's just for a second.
I wanted to see
Wonder Woman when I found out.
There's enough. The fact that they like allude to them is cool or whatever. Like those characters exist in this world, obviously. You know what I mean? But it's much different or whatever. You know what I mean? Like I didn't think this would be something that I really dug, but I really, really do dig it. And I'm loving it. Yeah. Rizzo in the house. What up, Riz? Riz says, oh, damn, hey. I didn't think you were doing a show tonight. Yes, I am. In fact, we're here. I saw your comment, messages coming into me, and I was like, oh, I guess he's not watching. Now you are. And then Riz says, I need to check them out. Yeah, man, totally watch Titans or whatever. Like I said, it could benefit from some fine tweaking on the writing. But otherwise, I think it's a really solid show. Any comic book fan can get through it, I think, because you read a lot of stuff in comic books. It's not necessarily all that or whatever. And this is good like,
too.
Cool.
It's fun to compare. Like, yeah. I don't read as many comics as you do, bro, which I should because I really like that aspect of it, but I'm a mom, so to sit down and read something is not, I can barely get the show in.
What's cool to me is when you can like ingest something in its own medium, like, hey, this is a show, like, there's obviously aspects of this show that are not like
there's a nut in here, y'all.
Is it? There's aspects of the show that are not like the comic or whatever, but that's fine or whatever, because it's like, it's its own thing or whatever, like, it's almost like, you know, in this universe, that these are the Titans the way they are, or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. So, like I said, I think that it's not even like, I don't even think it's Dick Grayson and Starfire that have something. It's Tim Drake, you know what I mean? And
Well, it's a Robin.
Robin. Yeah, but in this one, you know, specifically, whatever. So it's pretty cool. Really cool. All right, guys. Well, shoot, we appreciate you guys hanging out. Those of you that did, even if you just showed up, I want to wish a good luck to everybody tomorrow that is going to be doing Dale Eckman's show. Mm-hmm. Everyone, please be safe. Wear your masks.
Save us some cool toys, guys.
Yeah, wear your masks, wash your hands, sanitize. If you're going to have that at your station, great. For yourself, offer it to your customers too. So awesome. I wish that I could be there and go there just with the experience that we had. You know, I don't want to risk that for my own personal collecting. And I mean, like, I can wait, you know what I mean? And my nephew can wait. He wants to go too, you know, but, Joe says, I really need to cover the animated movies. They're great. Yeah, I totally agree. And then he says, DCEU kills on the movies. No doubt. Man, I believe it. Rizzo says, same here. Yes, man. I want everyone that's going to do that show to be safe, whatever. And yeah, it's good that if you're going to go and support those vendors, I mean, I get it. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we're all fully vaccinated at my house and we had someone fully vaccinated still come up.
Right.
We obviously also know, someone else that was fully vaccinated that also came up. But
it happens. You just gotta be safe, guys. It happens. You know, and
luckily none of us got hit hard or whatever, like I said. And even though I sound raspy and I sound like it, my allergies have been raging.
Yeah, the allergies.
They're raging. And I got two tests this week. They're both negative, so I'm blessed with that. And you got one. So but guys, I think that's it, right, sis? Anything else? Any final thoughts?
I think that's it, guys. You know, I just want to thank my brother and Double A for allowing me the opportunity to be on the show this week and last week. Although I wasn't well-versed in last week's because we had a variety of things going on, I really liked that it was a variety show.
Yeah.
And again, this week, I really wish I was able to finish or at least catch up on the Titans, but I feel like we did enough talking on just...
And you know
what? I did watch. Yeah, so that was really awesome.
A lot of Batman talk or whatever. But we said enough, I think, that we give you an opportunity to want to go and watch the show, whatever. Which, again, if you rewatch this episode, spoiler alert. Doesn't make sense to say it at the end, but lots of spoilers. Maybe I'll go put that in the comment. The show
I'm not as versed in a lot of what we talked about today, but I try to be because I'm into that and I hope to just learn more, you know, from my brother and that way. So
for you to watch the show, I wanted you to watch it. Yeah. Sure, a good show. The other show that I was gonna have you watch instead of this show was the
Now there's a fly in here.
It's just like a straight up fly. What the hell? The show I was gonna have you watch was the Superman and Lois show.
I know you had been mentioning that one to me. Maybe I can get to that one as soon as I
Yeah, because Double A told me he's not gonna watch it. And should this situation ever arise again, I pray that it doesn't. Yeah. But even if it just means, I mean, we do the bonus episodes.
Yeah.
And I can have, you
if
know,
you totally
watch
do the bonus episodes. I mean, I'll watch it if we're gonna do a bonus episode.
Yeah,
I really
because
love...
I wanna talk about those things sometimes, but I don't have the opportunity to talk about them with Double A. So let me read Rizzo's comments here. Riz says, same thing, not risking it. Good. Unfortunately, I know, man, it is. It really is. He says, allergies have sucked totally. he says, you did great last week. Thank you. Appreciate that, man. And he says, Joe says, good night. Great stuff, guys. Thank you, Joe. Good night, brother. Let me know how that hangover is tomorrow. Hoping to be there with you.
Sleep in,
faux show. All right, guys, well, there's something that we like to say at the end of every show. And that is, guys, if there's something that you want to do, a dream that you have, a hope that you wish to accomplish, go out there and do it, guys. Seize the day. There's no time like the present to go and make that happen. Now, do it safely if it is in the time of Corona and Delta. Wear your mask, get vaccinated first, but then go and seize the day. I mean, there's a smart and careful ways to do everything. The other thing we like to say is, like the great and legendary and iconic hero Captain America says in Endgame, you got to do whatever it takes. You're just doing whatever it takes in order to save half of existence. But you also, too, can do whatever it takes. Seize the day, do whatever it takes. Kind of the same thing. You know what I mean? You're seizing the day, but you're doing whatever it takes. We say both, though, so that we can remind you there's two different ways to approach it. You know what I mean?
And I'd like to add something to that.
All right.
So
Let's do it.
I always liked sign matu, which means without fear. So anything that you do, you seize the day, you do it without fear.
Interesting. They talk about fear and the Batman stuff, whatever. You know, fear is Batman's primary tool, whereas with Superman, it's hope. So I like the hope aspect better. No, I'm wearing a Batman shirt. But guys,
he's a Batman fan.
Yeah, for myself, CM Chuck, and my sister and podcast partner for the
I got
third time now.
And Tame with Amy. We love you guys and be safe out there.
Good night.